Hello and welcome to Carp Fishing Edges Volume 5. Coming up in this instalment, we've got 5 individual films covering a whole host of carp fishing scenarios. First up is Tom Maker and Lewis Porter, who are off to RK Leisure's Wraysbury Complex, and they get up close and personal with some of the historic venue's incredible inhabitants.
Join myself and Tom at the historical Wraysbury. We're right under the Heathrow flight path, so you might hear the odd plane whilst we're filming over the next few days, but it's all good. It's not going to put the carp off. We've got a bit of an exciting project for this part of the DVD. Myself, I'm not actually going to be fishing. My job is to be watching a couple of underwater cameras that we've got in the lake. Tom's going to be fishing, and yeah, it's pretty exciting, Tom.
Yeah, something completely different. I've never done it before. I've never fished Wraysbury before. So yeah, here we are, ready to rock and roll.
So basically, just to give you a quick overview of our plan, we arrived earlier on today and we've put the underwater cameras in a spot in the margin near some marginal bushes. We've fed a few handfuls of sweet corn, some hemp,
a few crushed boilies
and krill boilies. And the idea is for one, to try and get the carp confident feeding, but also to try and clear the spot a little bit. There is a bit of debris on there, old bits of twig and silt in amongst the gravel. So we're hoping that the fish will come in, feed with some confidence in front of the camera and clear the spot, ready for when Tom puts his rig in, which will be tomorrow.
Tomorrow morning, yeah.
Yep. So for the time being, you're gonna get 2 rods sorted in open water, which won't be in front of a camera, but you're gonna fish them identically to
exactly,
the rod in the margin,
exactly,
that's right?
Yep. Yeah, I mean, there's still 50 acres of water out in front, so it'd be mad not to explore that, find a spot, get a couple of rigs, like I say, exactly the same as what we're gonna be placing in the margins to start off with, bait them up, hopefully catch a fish tonight, and then tomorrow morning, go in and try and catch one in front of the camera.
Really exciting, like I say, we've had the cameras in for a few hours now. We have seen the odd fish creeping around on the periphery of the area, and we're just going to hope that as the afternoon goes on, they'll feed with gusto, get their confidence up. All night tonight they'll feed with no pressure, and then tomorrow, fingers crossed, Tom can put his rig in and we can catch, what would you like to catch live in front of the camera? Anything?
A fish to start with. It's not as if we're fishing for a small fish either. There's sort of 14 to 16 fish that go over 40 pounds in here as well.
The king of the lake.
King fungus is probably one of the most historic carp swimming, as well as a few others as well. So you never know, something might happen. We'll try.
One thing's for sure, it's going to be an exciting session and I can't wait for us to get started.
Right, so this is the rig that I'm going to be going in with on the 2 rods that are out in the open water, and also the one that's down positioned in front of the camera. The 360 rig, probably one of the favourite rigs for a lot of anglers, I suppose, me included. Just talk you through it. First things first, pre-tied dark camo lead core leader, fished on a lead clip. This is just so the lead drops off, the fish comes up and away from the snags and we can land them safely. On the end of there, quick change clip, the rig, so we can just chop and change rigs as and when we please. Boom section itself, Camotex semi-stiff. This is the light camo one in 25 pound. Nice big blob of putty in the middle there to keep it all pinned to the bottom. And then the business end. So I've got a size 11 ring swivel, which is just looped on the end of the material. And that's pretty much all you need to do in terms of any sort of tying on the rig. Next thing, a medium curve size 5 hook is then threaded through the eye of the swivel. The first hook bead goes down, which secures your distance between the eye of your hook and your first bead, which gives you the movement of the rig. Then a micro hook swivel there, which the hook bait's attached to, and that's all secured in place by another hook bead. But one of the vital things with this rig, and it does have a lot of bad press and people say it's dangerous and it's this and it's that, All you need to do is simply a piece of shrink tube over the eye of the hook. That's the main problem that people have when the fish goes into the net. With this, there's nothing for the fish to catch on. So all you do is when you're netting the fish, you're engulfing the whole fish to make sure the fish is at the bottom of the landing net. When you come to transferring it to the water, hopefully I can show you when I catch one on it, if and when. Literally unhook it, roll your net down, and take the fish up to the mat. So hopefully we'll put it into practice.
Okay, so now into the exciting stages. Yesterday we baited up in front of the camera, try and get the fish's confidence up and also to get them to clean the spot a bit and get rid of some of the debris. The fish came in yesterday afternoon. We counted over 20 different fish, including three of the real gems of the lake, including, by great luck, king fungus, which is, I'm told, going to be somewhere between 45 and 50 pounds, a real history fish, and we had it feeding in front of the cameras yesterday with no rigs in, and it was really lapping up the krill and the bloodworm that that Tom's been putting in. So we resisted the temptation to fish for him yesterday and just decided it was best to let them carry on feeding with no rig in the water, leave it unmolested last night, and then put the rig in this morning. So the guys have just put the rig in. We've got two screens set up. We've got two cameras, one shooting on a wide and then the other one shooting much more zoomed in on the rig and the hook bait itself. So hopefully over the course of today we're going to get some fish come back in and feed on the spot. So basically yesterday evening the fish had wiped out all of the free bait that the guys had put in at the start, so we topped up the spot again. There's some bloodworm pellets, krill boilies whole and chopped, and some krill pellets as well. So they put a bucket of bait in last night. That's about 10-15 kilos, probably a real good amount of bait. Put that in last night, turned the camera on this morning, and there's still quite a bit of the bait there, but there are the odd fish coming in and starting to feed. And we do expect, as the day goes on and it gets warmer, more fish will come in because we're fishing in the margins. So the rig's in, and Tom's using the washing line method to present this rig. So his line's going all the way above the surface of the water to a bank stick, and then the leader's coming back in off the near margin with the rig presented, so there's no line going through the swim at all. This is real close quarters fishing, right in the margin, so we want to keep as much line out of the water as possible and give ourselves as best chance as possible of hooking one of these A-team. Like I say, we've seen paw print in front of the camera, we've seen king fungus, so some real Wraysbury gems in front of the camera yesterday, and we're just hoping that they come back today now that Tom's got his little pink signature pop-up waiting for him. Fish on the spot feeding. Fish on the spot feeding. Come on, it's here, mate. Oh, don't think you like them driving away. There's a fish very close. He's had a mouthful. He's moved off. He was that close, the rig is wafting about. Well, you can see Tom's 360 rig is sitting absolutely perfect at the moment. The hook is just cocked up off the swivel. He's critically balanced his pop-up just to sit it up nice. And it looks perfect for a bite. I think as soon as a fish comes in and makes a beeline for that pink pop-up, I don't think he's going to stand a chance. Right, we've got two fish coming in, Tom. Make that three. It's happening, it's building, isn't it? It's building.
That's what you want, a couple of fish.
He's been and had a look at it. He's gone back, he said, guys, come and have a look at this. What do you reckon? What are you saying? Is it safe?
How's it looking, Lou?
They're just sitting off the back of it a bit on the other side of that stump, I think.
But it's encouraging. There's three fish now having a look rather than just that one, so looks like they're starting to turn up a bit more in numbers.
Hopefully a little bit of competition might get one of them to have a munch.
Well, you're on the dance floor, mate, and you've got your best attire on, so it's only a matter of time.
As long as they're on the dance floor, we're rocking.
Fish on the spot, Tom. Here he goes, come on. Come on, my son, have that pink pop-up. He's looked at it, he's mugged you right off.
Coming in, taking one mouthful, maybe two, upright, swim away. I think it's just a case of building their confidence.
Beeline for the hook bait, real close now. He's feeding all around it.
I'm hovering over it, Lee.
So is the fish. Oh, there's one just coming into shot.
Are they all the same fish or are they different ones?
There's been a couple of new ones appear in the last, like the last couple of fish that have come in, I think. None of the big girls yet, though.
You normally get them big girls on the dance floor at the end of the night.
I think you'd have a better chance of tempting them with a kebab, though, than a pink pop-up.
I don't think that pop-up's a ball of candy floss.
Right, they're in now. There's three fish feeding. Hover over the rod, Tom. Four fish.
I can see what's coming. I'm going to slip in there. I get so excited, I just walk off the end. I'll tell you what, that's probably be over my head there as well.
I'd love to be there watching it. I'd rather be the one watching it than fishing for it.
That was the most aggressive that they've been then, weren't it? Three of them just going into it. Here we go. Come on. Right. Real close now. Real close. Come on. There's one unit as well. Here we go. Here we go. Here we go. Here we go. Come on. Come on. Here we go. Right close, right close. Come on. Oh! Honestly, come on, one of you. Come on, turn around, have it.
Are they still there? Are they still in the peg or are they left now?
They're just in the back of it.
Right, they're back feeding the gaff. Don't think it's going to be too long now. We're starting to get some competitive feeding. Right, oh! It'd be nice linear.
What does that mean?
Here we go. Starting to cloud up quite a bit now. The fish are stirring it up a bit, so visibility's not as good as we had before, but that bite's got to be close.
Won't spook off our rig though, were they? Yeah, two fish either side of the rig, and neither one of them spooked by it, like sat up off the bottom or anything.
Are they still there, Lou?
Yeah, they're just off the back of it. They got that close, their fin wafted the rig and it's moved the hook over one of the little twigs, and we're struggling to see whether it's impeding how the rig will work now. We just gotta wait, see if a fish sucks it in and whether it can move freely or not.
The thing is, all of that stuff, you never know what's going on.
No.
So you just gotta leave it.
Yeah, you can't move it. Sometimes I think if you make it too perfect, that's why you struggle. Like, no different to them rods, is it? You drop them, do whatever you want, but if you're in a normal situation, you've got a cast, haven't you? And I don't think half the time, I don't think it matters how your rig sits. If the fish is competitive and it's feeding, it's going to have whatever's in front of it. It's just, well, that's proved it. They're not going to pick it up straight away, are they? So how many times does that happen when you're fishing? I reckon it happens all the time. I probably caught my fair share of fish on a tangled rig. That's why sometimes three rods on one spot's better, because that's one rod and it's hooked over a branch. If you had another two on it and one of them was perfect, it might be that's the rod what goes. I don't know.
Right, we've got one very, very close. Very, very close. He's... Oh! I think that counts as the first time you've been actually mugged off.
Can I pick it up?
His lips touched the bait and then he turned off of it.
Well, I've got to do the over dramatic bit if it comes off.
Oh no!
I'll do a Mozza and just got to stop recording, guys.
Right. There's one feeding right next to it now. Prepare yourself. Old split peck is on the spot. That's fat, isn't it?
Brace yourself, we got split peck, which is a unit. It's right close, he's wanting it. He's looking at it.
We'll end up being a nervous wreck by the end of the day. Got a hook one, ain't we, in a minute. It'll be mint when it rips off.
His peck's touching the hook. He's so close. He's
You can't help but not get excited, can you? If you didn't get excited, there'd be something wrong with you. I don't think I could fish like it all the time. You don't want to know this is going on every time you fish, would you?
It's good. Right, we got one now coming in behind us, coming in behind it. He's real close. Peck's just touching the bait.
It's Daryl's knocking the bait, is it?
He's Daryl was touching the bait. It's like surface fishing, isn't it? Like you're watching them and you're thinking, if you try to chase them about, they just always turn the different way to how you want them to turn.
Honey G, do you receive?
Wicked. Right, sucked in, go!
Come on. Right, it's out into the open now. Jesus. Don't go for that weed bed. Don't go for it. Oh my God, yeah, you feel everything on braid. Absolutely everything. Every shake of the head, every time it flicks. I'm getting a little bit back on it. Just gone right in behind a massive weed bed that's on the surface. Oh, that's grating on something. Oh, mate, it's in that weed. It's absolutely solid in it. No. Mate, that's not coming out of there. That is absolutely solid in there. Right, well, we just had that bite off the bottom. Done exactly what it should have done. Lead's come off, the fish has come away from the snag. We're playing it out in the open water. Got a real depth of water out in front of me, sort of 16 to 18 foot. And the weed in places is top to bottom, and as is the way the fish has found its way into a weed bed. It's quite dense. I've had it on for probably 20 minutes now. It's just sat in the weed bed. I've been trying to give it a line. It's not taking any. I think the only option, get the life jacket on, jump in the boat, get above it, and hopefully we can pull it up and free it. So yeah, let's get the jacket on, get the net in the boat, and off we go. Went straight out, I couldn't stop it, mate, straight in the...
I had the clutch, it was fizzing.
Yeah, it's in the thickest, well, the only part of the weed out there that's on the surface, so I knew where it was going. Jump in, Lou.
Okay, mate.
Don't knock me over the side.
Just hope it's okay, because I know the bailiff said there's a lot of muscles in the weed out there.
Fair bit of muscle in the boat at the minute, I've got to be honest. There it is. Lead come off, everything, pulling it up, cut. Oh well.
Weed is savage.
Such is life. Such is life, Lewis. I'll try and get out of here now. This would be the icing on the cake, wouldn't it, if I fell in off of it?
Yeah, I'll take your rod.
Clamber aboard. Oh, Harry. Yep, lead had come off. Once we got above it, it pulled up pretty easy, but I think it had shedded it and gone, and it just left all that knotted in the weed. Have a nice holiday. Well, there we go. Here's a sample of just a handful of weed that I've managed to grab out of the margin. And you can see straight away, there's the reason why you're getting cut off and why that fish has managed to cut the hook link. That was a 25 pound coated braid hook link, and there's tons and tons of weed loaded with tons and tons of zebra mussels, and unfortunately on this occasion the fish won, so back to the drawing board. Unfortunately, after that lost fish, hasn't been much more activity on the spot. We also found out earlier on that one of the fish that we saw on the camera yesterday in the evening has been caught 500 yards away down the other end of the lake, which, if I'm honest, tells us all we need to know. There's been a lot less activity in the bay itself after we've been out in the boat. as carp fishing, I suppose, we haven't got weeks on end to try and get them back in there and get them confident again. We're on limited time, so what we're going to do, pack up, going to wind the rods in, go for a scout round, and hopefully we can find somewhere else on the complex to drop the cameras in and continue getting bites. So let's get them in. Watch the prop. Oh, it's like a John Wilson show. Don't go under the boat. Don't go under the boat. It's early morning now. We moved over from the North Lake last night onto the south, which is literally just the other side of the road. And again, similar problems over there. The lake's really weedy, but massive clear spots over here, so I had a quick chuck around the lead when I got in the peg. Found a clear spot, not too far out. Don't really want to be fishing a long way out in this weed. Started off by putting a little bit of bait on it, 10-12 spods, and a wafter with a piece of corn over the top. Just the rig that I would use everywhere, really. Had a couple in the night. I'd say first light now, and I've had a couple already this morning. Keep trickling the bait, and it'd be really interesting actually to put this rig in front of the camera and see the reaction, because I think this is the fifth or the sixth one I've had now, so yeah, it'd be interesting to see if it has the same effect as what the 360 did, nailing them straight away. You can do, Lewis, if you want. Yes, be very generous of you. Oh, lead's come off, free of all the weed. Keep your head up, Lou, just so it can't see your face in it. I think that's Mary, isn't it?
It did look like Mary. I got a glimpse of it. It did look like Mary.
Get Pete on the phone. He'll confirm it.
Chris Ball will be able to tell
you. Oh, yes. That's Mary, that is. Get it in. Don't miss it, Lou.
I'm not going to stab at it.
Don't miss it. It's three captures in the last 28 years. Don't miss it. Get in the net!
No.
Oh, no! No! All I've got is the corn rig. Look! That's the most horrendous piece of angling I've ever seen. Viewers, that's the worst piece of angling I've ever seen. He genuinely had the hook in the mesh of the landing net. I don't know what to say. I've been on here years for that fish.
I couldn't lift the net up.
That's horrendous. I've fished with him once in 9 years, and he's lost me Mary. That fish was well in that net. That was horrendous. I tell you, put that on the outtakes, H. That's horrendous. I don't even know what to say to that. I've never seen anything as abysmal in my life. Just go and sit on that island with you all day.
I can't believe you're blaming me for that.
Who else is there to blame? Who would you have blamed, Lee?
Oh, dear.
Who netted the fish? I'm netting all of the fish now. I've never seen that happen. I've never had that happen to me. In all the years I've carp fished, I've never ever had someone manage to use the net, a 42-inch landing net, as a disgorger.
That's not what happened, you.
I might put it to Matrix. They've got to bring one out. 42-inch disgorger is far quicker than the plastic ones.
Well, another one on. So again, caught in a little bit of weed. Luckily enough, the lead's come off, the fish is on the surface. I'm gonna clamber down here, try not to fall in. And hopefully I can bundle him, looks a nice fish. Bundle him into the net. In we go. And there he is. Another Wraysbury South Lake carp. There we go. A lovely 17 pound Wraysbury South Lake mirror. I caught a few fish now, got another one in the net, which I'll show you in a minute. It's equally as stunning as this one. They're obviously loving the spot that I found out there. Well, let's hope they've got the same reaction to the area in front of the camera, because these fish really are feeding hard. The hook hold on this fish was absolutely phenomenal. So hopefully we can go out to the camera, put the same rig there, and yeah, see how it all fares up in front of the camera. How about that for a stunning carp? The fish in Wraysbury South really are something special. And although these are the stock fish, let me tell you, when these grow big in a few years' time, there'll be people after these, you know, target fish. Every fish we've had has been equally as stunning. This one's sort of 16, 17 pounds, similar size to the one that you just saw, but jet black already, perfect linear. So get this one back and hopefully I can catch a few more of them. Okay, so this is the rig which I'm using now, which I've got my two rods out in the open water, and also the one that's fishing in front of the camera. No real need to continue with the 360. In my opinion, I'm sure you guys will agree too, it's absolutely devastating. The first fish that come into contact with the rig, the hook done is exactly what it should do, spun on the swivel, bang, straight in the bottom lip, and the fish was hooked. So moving on to the second rig, and another rig which I use a hell of a lot, it's just a simple knotless knot wafter rig. 25 pound Camatex semi-stiff in the light, blob of putty just to hold everything down. I've got on the end there a size 5 wide gape straight point. I either use this with a straight pointed hook or a beak point. I'm not too fussed really. This one in particular is a straight point. Hair's just trapped via a small piece of hook silicone there. And then on the business end, a krill wafter and a piece of plastic corn. One of the biggest elements with this rig, and I see a lot of people do it, when they're fishing with a wafter, they fish with the hook flat on the bottom. It's not something I personally like to do. I like to have it so the hook is sat proud of the bottom, and all I do is make a small break just past the eye of the hook there, just to allow the hook that movement. So in theory, when it goes out there, and I've done quite a lot of testing, so I know sort of how much to shave off the pop-up, off the wafter, sorry, to balance it down, and the rig in effect should sit so the hook is just hovering above the bottom like so. So that's the rig, small loop on the end there, and that attaches to the quick clip on the end of my leg clip setup, exactly the same as what I had on before. This time I just got a slightly bigger cling on lead because we are fishing at a bit of distance and I don't want to be moving the hook bait once it's in position. So once that's on, it's out there and we're fishing. Okay, I'm just going to show you through the bait which I'm using over here on the South Lake. Mix, very, very simple. There's not a lot of visual colour to it. It's more of a pellet-based mix because the fish that are in this lake, they're quite young. They've not long been in here, and they would have been reared on pellets. That would be silly of me to go in with anything different other than pellets and a few boilies. Base of the mix, I've got a few handfuls of hemp and a little bit of hemp juice there just to add a bit of moisture to the mix. 2.3 mil bloodworm pellets and 2.3 mil manila pellets. They're mixed up and they're all in there. Reason for the small pellets, the fish, as I say, were bred and reared on the pellets. The smaller pellets are gonna go out, they're gonna fall between the crevices of the rocks on the gravel which I'm fishing over, and it's gonna keep the fish troughing for longer. The bloodworm pellets themselves as well, they leak off a real red haze, so there's always attraction on the spot. Into this, got quite a few kilos of manila, got a few manila whole ones and quite a lot of chops in there. Again, loaded full of attraction, different sizes as well, so I can vary my hook baits over the top. And to be honest with you, that's pretty much the mix. All I've done after that, just to add more liquid to the mix, is I've added half a bottle of cloudy manila liquid. Now what this does is it means that the pellets aren't breaking down before I'm spotting them out. I don't want them to be sort of loaded with water, so I'm spotting out a pulp. I want the pellets to be going out and going down on the bottom hole. And also what I'm doing before I'm spotting out is I'm just giving the handful of bait I'm putting in there a squeeze, so it's falling down through the water, almost like a ground bait ball. So when it's landing on the bottom, it's landing in a big clump, and then the fish are coming in and they're breaking it apart, and it's always leaking out of traction. Now this mix is quite a bit different to what you'd have probably seen me using over on the North Lake, for obvious reasons really. Wraysbury had a hell of a lot of original fish in it, real old fish like king fungus, so on and so on. And they now reside in the north side of the lake, which is where we were fishing, and was using krill over there. Now the krill, through its development stages and its testing stages, was used massively on Wraysbury, and these fish would have seen it. And as you would have seen, fungus was in on it over there, so you know, he still knows. And I've actually got a bite. So we'll cut that there. I'll play this in. The fish is on the surface. I'm sat like a bit of an idiot, but I will get up and focus. My hand is extremely sticky from the manila liquid, but I'm playing the fishing. So as you would have probably seen from looking out into the lake, it is extremely weedy, and the lake itself is quite deep as well, and that weed's top to bottom. So in places you're looking at sort of 12 to 14 foot of solid weed. You don't want to be turning up to these venues with light rods, light line and small hooks. It's just, if you're turning up doing that, you're basically going to be fishing for lost fish. You really want beefy kit. I mean, I'm only fishing at like 60 odd yards. I've got 3.5 test curve Horizon X. Spools are loaded up with 20 pound Exa set as well. Proper beefy kit. Business end, I've got no leader. All I've got on is my leg core leader. Fish with a leg clip so the lead can drop off, which is therefore getting the fish higher up in the water. Rig material, 25 pound down to a size 6 or a 5 hook, which is quite a beefy piece of metal. So if I'm hooking fish, I don't want to be losing them. A lot of the sort of common faults I see when people are fishing in weed is they'll try and fish a slack line. Well, for a starters, your indication is massively reduced by fishing in weed anyway. So the last thing you want to be doing is fishing with a slack line. And also what they'll do is if a fish goes into weed, they'll instantly put the rod on the rest, panic, let the line go slack. I'm actually going to grab the net quickly because this fish is nearly ready, which I believe is over the back of there. I see a lot of people, first thing they do, the fish goes in the weed and then they're slacking it off. That's the worst thing you can do. Keep the pressure on, keep the fish moving, and they should kick free. This one's coming, as you can see, quite a ball of weed on it, but gentle pressure all the way through. I know there's a ball of weed, but sometimes it can work in your favour because that fish is completely engulfed in there. Doesn't really know what's going on until he's over the jaw cord, and you can see there he's just poking out, completely chilled out, hasn't really sussed out what's going on yet. And then once you make sure all the fish and the weed's engulfed in the net, jump down, peel back the weed and unveil the prize, which is exactly what I'm going to do. And there you go, he knows he's in there now, but it's too late. Another Wraysbury South Stocky. Hearing from the guys over there who are sat watching the underwater cameras that there's not much happening at the minute. I've had a couple of carp pass, but nothing that's massively interested. But heat of the day now, and it seems that out where I'm fishing, certainly the scent of the bait is dragging them down, because we're seeing quite a few fish cruising through the weed and we're still getting bites off the bottom. So hopefully, fingers crossed, that the fish get a little bit further afield and they start munching in front of the underwater camera. But for now, I'm happy to keep plodding through a few of these. Well, good morning, and what a way to start. It's fantastic, 20 pound, 10 ounce Wraysbury mirror. Unfortunately, through the remainder of yesterday and this morning, the fish just haven't got in front of the camera, which is a real shame because I'd have loved to have seen their reaction to the wafter rig in front of the camera. This again was nailed on it, out on the open water spot, which I've been keeping regularly topped up with a bit of spod mix. Like I say, it's unfortunate that it hasn't happened over here. However, the footage that we got from the North Lake is absolutely fantastic. So what I'll do is I'll slip this one back, get the kit packed up and head for home.
Some incredibly exciting and eye-opening footage there. And of course, as usual, Tom Maker doing the business. Now, Frimley is a place that is very near and dear to my heart. Indeed, Frimley Pit 3 holds probably the greatest population of big common carp in the country. However, Lee Mozza Morris enjoyed a great first season on the slightly larger and slightly trickier Pit 4 next door. And luckily for us, Lee took his camera along and here he is to recount his story.
At the moment I'm fishing Pit 4, which is on the Frimley complex. I suppose the stories that I heard before were it's not for the faint-hearted, so it's a challenge over here and I'm game for that. You know, there's nothing better in my eyes than really working hard for your fish. As weird as this sounds, I quite like lakes, you know, sort of kicking me up the backside a little bit. It makes me fish a lot better. Most of my angling is taken up by syndicate fishing, to be fair. It's something I enjoy doing because a lot of the times they can be fairly quiet. So I normally fish on a Sunday and Monday nights, and a lot of the times I get the place to myself so I can get on with my own fishing. I used to target specific fish, but I vowed never to do that ever again. The Nutsy fish, for instance, completely done my head in, and after I'd caught that fish, because it was such a massive fish, I vowed really never to target a fish ever again. And it's always about the beauty of them now. So it's not so much the weights anymore or a certain fish, it's how they look, you know, nice scaly ones, commons, you know, it's just, you know, the stock and its beauty. The lake itself is around about 25 acres. There's 100 odd fish in here, so it's not a low stock venue. But I think it's been hard in the past for people because of how weedy it's got. A lot of the members said to me, you know, it's like a football pitch out there, and it's a struggle to get on any spots, and it's a struggle obviously to get fish in. But this year I've got lucky because none of the weeds come up whatsoever, pretty much. So, you know, I found a lot of spots in a lot of swims, and I've managed to, you know, get on with my own fishing and not have the weed sort of ruin my chances. I got my ticket early April, and for the first 3 weeks unfortunately I couldn't get up here just because of work commitments, but I planned my session. So I sort of come up here on the weekend, the 17th of April it was, and decided to sort of have a bit of a lead round, but that wasn't possible, unfortunately, because the lake was packed. There was a lot of people on here, and it had been doing a fair few fish as well for them first 3 weeks. So there's a corner of the lake called No Carp Corner, and no one was near it whatsoever. So, and it's the furthest swim away from the car park. So I thought, right, well, that's a good starting point. And I couldn't find a spot in there anywhere, to be honest with you. So what I did was I decided to try and create a spot in there by putting a load of boilie out on a certain area that wasn't as weedy as the rest of the lake. So I did that on the Saturday. I come back on the Sunday, did it again with the plan to fish it Monday night and Tuesday night. But got up here around about 11 o'clock in the morning, and there was one car in the car park. So I thought, well, happy days, everyone's gone from the lake. Starts barrowing my stuff all the way around, so I get all the way around to the other side of the lake. Still haven't found matey yet, and he set up in the swim. And obviously, he didn't know I was baiting it. good angling on his behalf because he saw a load of fish in there. So I thought, right, okay. So I've come back down the railway bank towards a massive swim, which is called Barbecue. So I chucked the rod out and instantly it's sort of gone boom, just landed on a gravelly area straight away. I've sort of looked around as if matey's heard it. It's unbelievable, considering that I'd been leading around in that corner and hadn't found a spot anywhere. I thought I was going to struggle in this Barbecue swim, but first chuck, bang, lovely spot. So I clicked it up, back out there, a couple of taps off the rod, and then it was into a bit of silkweed. So I thought, here we go, this is perfect. So that was two rods sorted. I could fish two rods on that area, and it was around about 18 wraps out. And as I'm deciding the other rod, a commons launched itself clean out of the water. I thought, right, that's perfect, that other area. So I didn't lead round out there. Because I'd seen the fish show, I just put pinch stiff rig out there with just a long, supple boom on it. So got the rods out, all sorted, happy as. Then a guy's come round, one of the old members. He said to me, you know, I was at your first session and we're having a chat. And I went, yeah, yeah. And he said, well, yeah, I fished it hard last year. And I was like, oh, right, what did you have? And he hadn't had anything for the whole year, and he had fished it hard and the year previous to that as well. So I'm sort of sat there thinking, well, I knew it was hard, but to go a couple of years without a fish, that's going to hurt. It's going to hurt anyone. So it got to about 4 o'clock in the morning, and I have had the take of all takes. I've never had a take like it. Literally middle rods just absolutely torn off. I've levitated myself up out of the bed. I'm out of the bed before the sleeping bags hit the bottom of the bed chair. So I'm out, got my boots on, ran down, and as I'm running down to the rod, the bite is like, the reel is going that much. It's obviously, it's still quite dark at this point. The reel's actually flashing because I'm using fluorocarbon. The static's building up on the reel, and I can see it sparking with what, and you can hear all the static going. This reel's going. I've picked the rod up, and it's just going like nothing I've ever heard before. I was giggling to myself because it was that crazy, and then the adrenaline kicked in. Then, so I've managed to fight me waders on, dogged this fish all the way back to the swim. And yeah, you know, the rest is history, really. It wasn't an epic fight or anything like that. I've just pumped the fish all the way back after it had gone on that crazy run. He had worn himself out. And then I got my first fish in the net on my first night. It's unbelievable. Sun's coming up at that point, birds are singing, and I was just absolutely loving life, as you could well imagine. So it went £34, you know, a beautiful, typical Pit 4 common. And yeah, I was just totally amazed by it, to be honest with you. After a guy telling me he'd done a 2-year blank only the day previous to me catching one on my first night, it was just incredible. So my approach on it when I first started was, I wanted to get a bait established in here. You know, I know that they like a lot of bait in here just by talking to members that have fished it in the past, and they've, all of them have said to me, put as much bait in as you possibly can. That's really been the approach that I've gone with, is just put lots and lots of bait in here. Now, I know a few people might say, oh, well, he gets it for free, that's all right. But that is what I used to do in the past when I had to pay for it. So, you know, I'd spend every single penny I possibly could on bait, because, you know, if you can get the fish established to a bait, 9 times out of 10, you're on a winner there. So that's really been my approach. Sometimes I'll use a load of hemp as well. I use a lot of the whole particle hemp in here, and I mix them up with snails, and they've got another one with chili hemp as well. The chili hemp I find goes really well with a switch, so I use a lot of that as well. So my next trip down, I planned a 48-hour trip again, but it was a bit of bad angling, to be honest with you, because I had had that fish out of that Barbecue swim, and I hadn't bothered walking around or looking for the fish whatsoever. I just went straight back in there and blanked for 48 hours. Didn't see anything, and yeah, just didn't set up on them really. I just went on the whim because of that fish that I'd caught the week previous. I thought, you know, it's a best starting point. And yeah, nothing happened, unfortunately. And then my rainbow trip come up, and that's pretty much a month out of my life. It takes me a week to get ready for rainbow, and then I'm out there for 2 weeks, and then a week to try and sort my life out when I get back from there. So the whole of May, I couldn't fish down there, and it was clubbing season on here. I was on rainbow, my mates are texting me saying, oh, mate, he's had three tonight, and another geezer's had two, and another guy's had one. And at that point, I was actually blanking on rainbow as well, whilst this place was fishing its head off. But that all came good in the end, because I ended up catching a fish of my dreams out of rainbow, a 71-pound carp that just blew me away, completely blew me away, and memories that will live on forever.
Right then, let me rod right up the back. It's gone again. Last day, Friday. Oh, sh**. Tree there. So this will be my very last chance. Let's hope that there's a rainbow pig on the end waiting for Mozza's net. That would be nice. Come on, Mr. Boat, please go quicker. Proper buzzing, as I always am. Very close. Come on, boat! Oh, it's not a bad one. She's diving underneath the boat. I just saw her then. Big old mirror. Way. Oh, scares me when you see him. So yeah, let's get out here. Play you out this way. Oh my God. It's thousand scale. Oh my God. It's thousand scale. Oh my God. Oh my God. Oh my God. Please, rainbow. Please. 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 Get in that net. Please get in the net. Yes! Get in there! Yes! Oh man. That is a pig, dude. Oh mate, oh, I can't believe it. Oh my God. Oh my God. Oh my God.
I've got thousand scale. At a monumental 71 pounds. And something ounces, I don't care how many ounces it is, I am absolutely blown away by this fish, like you wouldn't believe. Like, never have I been speechless before, but oh my God, what a creature. And thank you, Rainbow, for finally blessing me with one of your finest. Just what an incredible beast. Yeah.
So back from rainbow, obviously buzzing to get back down there, buzzing from that rainbow trip. And I obviously was going to try and find the fish this time. So I pulled up into the car park, and as soon as you walk out the car park area, there's a big lawn area which you can see a majority of the lake from. And there's a couple of fish just sort of about 15 or 20 yards out in front of me. There's sort of two fish there milling around, and I'm watching these two fish, and then this pack of carp have come up round the island and joined these two fish just sort of doing nothing. So they've come round and they're sort of sat with these other two, and then another group of fish have joined them. So I've watched this one pack and they're sort of going up and around the island, and the other group, they're sort of going the opposite way, but they're taking a much, much wider line around the island. So one group's going up from the left, one group's going up from the right. So I'm sort of weighing up the options of the best way to sort of fish for them two groups of fish. And then one of the syndicate members turned up, Tom, and he said to me, well, you're here first, you know, where are you going? So I sort of like said to him, right, I'm going to go over there into a swim, which is called the secret swim. So Tom adopted to go in this swim that we're in at the moment. And then early morning, I've sort of got up, I'm looking out, and there's tufties and birds just diving all over the area, and it just didn't look the one. It was high pressure and it just didn't look right for it, to be honest with you. And then the middle rod sort of picked up slowly. It's sort of taking line, you know, gradually, and I'm thinking, oh no, I've hooked a bird. And that, as I've leant into it, the birds have gone berserk, and then I've shot out into the lake, and then it's sort of like just kiting gently, and I'm like, I've definitely hooked a tufty here. And then all of a sudden it turned into a fish and started taking line off of me. And so I'm like, oh right, it's definitely a carp. So now it's like not really an epic fight, you know, just a sort of normal carp fight, and straight into the net. And I'd caught the kinky back fully. So that fish, although it wasn't an original pit four fish, it was one of the oldest actually on the complex. So I was really happy to catch that. And it was a 26 pounder and my first mirror from the venue as well. So I put that rod straight back out onto the right hand side of the island. And then I'd rebaited the left hand rod as well and put loads of bait out there. You know, I put a lot of boilie out on both of the areas. And it got to about 4 o'clock in the morning, and the left-hand rod was away this time. Just another blistering tag ran down, it into the rod, and then just, you know, nothing epic about this battle really. A sort of a bit of a dogged fight. Fish had kited round to the left a little bit, got me waders on all right, and then managed to get another fish in the net. Unbelievable, a 33 pounder, which they call white tips. So, you know, to have a brace of fish on my session back, I was just absolutely amazing, to be honest with you. And I was told that this white tips is one of the A-team fish because he hangs around with a lot of the A-team. So gone back to the bivvy, stuck the kettle on, that left-hand rod's away again. I couldn't believe it. When I joined pit four, I set myself the target to catch three fish. I knew it was going to be hard here, and I've just managed to bank three fish on only my third trip back to the venue, and I was just absolutely ecstatic. And it was a mega looking carp as well. Again, another typical pit four common. You know, there's some of the nicest commons I've ever laid eyes on that live in here. And that one went 36 pound and just again blew me away. At the time we were testing out the new edges hooks, so the stiff rig hooks that I had been sent were just perfect for me. I like a straight pointed hook, and we had these size sixes that were just perfect for me, and I'd been sent a handful, and it was like, you know, the email pretty much said, these are gold dust, you know, it's all we've got left, there's no more after this. So I sort of paced my angling out with these stiff rig hooks, and when I ran out, I was gutted. You know, I'd ran out literally a month before they'd gone out into the shops, and it was a bit like, oh, you know, I just can't find a hook that I'm happy with. But with that, we had a lot of other hooks as well. So I'm sort of rooting through my bag thinking, you know, this hook would be perfect for my tiger rig. The median curve with a couple of tigers on it was absolutely perfect for when the fish were out by the snags. And it's great, I suppose, as consultants, we get to test all these new and little things out. And it, again, it's a confidence thing, you know. Whenever you're confident in your angling, you'll always do well in your angling. And yeah, it's been quite cool because I've used a variety of rigs on pit four. I've used zig rigs and I've caught on them. Used a bottom bait rig with the tigers and I've caught on them. And obviously the hinge stiff rig as well, which I've caught most of my fish on this year, but that was all down to the straight point stiff rig hook. So my next few sessions, I I went back into the secret swim just because it looked good in there and I didn't see any fish in there, and unfortunately I blanked 48 hours. And then I struggled to find a fish on here. Like most of the times when I come down, I would always see something to go on, but just nothing, you know. And then I was pretty much going on what way the wind was blowing and what looked the best, you know, not really going in swims because fish were there. And then I ended up doing a few blanks because of it, but I wasn't the only person doing blanks. Everyone on here was blanking. So the fish had really sort of shut up shop and everyone was saying, you know, it's gone back to its original pit four, you know, hardness, I suppose. So I thought, do you know what, I've got to try something a little bit different. And I've got a drawer at home that's got all my tackle bits in. And as I've opened this drawer up, a packet of Ziggerline has fallen out the drawer and landed upright, just like basically staring back at me. So I'm sort of like looking at these Ziggerliners and just sort of shut the door, drawer, and thought, right, okay. So I've got these Ziggs and I've just chucked them in my pocket, wanted to forget about them a little bit really. So I've turned up at pit four. And I'm like, right, I'm gonna find fish this time. There was one guy on and he set up quite close to the car park, about three swims up from the car park. Said to him, have you seen anything? He's like, no, I haven't seen a thing, mate. I haven't seen a thing for a while. No one had seen any fish for a while on here either. So I've walked up all the way round into No Carp Bay and I've basically found what could only be the whole stock of the lake sat in that corner. They're all sat there, all in different layers of the water. Some are swimming around the edge. A friend of mine, Tom, had been baiting that area over there, so I thought, you know, I'll send him a text anyway, see if he didn't mind me going in there whilst I was walking back. So as I've pulled my phone out my pocket, my Ziggerliners have fallen back out, landed upright again, staring at me, and I'm like, right, well, I've obviously never found a spot in that No Carp corner, so my best bet is to obviously fish with these Ziggs. So I've put three Ziggs out there, stuck the rods down, and then like the fish are creeping up onto the shelf that's in there, and it's only a couple of foot deep and it's a real gravelly shelf, so you can really see the fish. And as they're sort of coming up, I'm all the time, I'm thinking, you know, I've got three rods out on Ziggs here, you know, and it got the better of me in the end. I wound one of the Zig rods in and put it up on the shelf on a little inch stiffy. So I've done that, and that was a big mistake because the whole night the fish were up on that shelf, but they were up in the water. The moon was bright. I could see them sort of like vortexing around right up on the shelf. I think I shouldn't have brought that rod in. I should have just like put a short Zig on and chucked it in the edge. But anyway, left the rods out for the night. Next morning, middle rods away.
Right then. Well, live and direct from Frimley. Well, as live as I can ever get anyway. We got a proper angry one on the end. Right under the stars, look, as you can see. Oh. So angry in here they are. Unbelievable. Wish this mozzie would get off my arm, it's doing me nothing. Come on, darling. Come on, sweetheart, this way, please. Come on, then. Oh, it keeps pinging off its dorsal and everything. It's horrendous.
I've walked out to the limit of my boat. I've got the net right on reach, and this fish is just fighting all in front of the net. And I'm like, please, just stop for a second.
Stop fighting. Please stop fighting. Please, you're nearly there. Right on the edge of the net. Yes! Oh, she's in there. Yes! Oh, sweet. Oh, happy days.
Couldn't believe it. And yeah, that fish, although it was the smallest fish out of it, it probably meant the most because I feel like I'd worked for that fish, you know, doing all the blanks previous to that and then catching that one. It was an absolute beautiful looking common, you know, that was epic, you know, and to have another fish out of here again, just couldn't believe it, to be honest with you, and on a different tactic, which was nice. So I've always sort of kept them Ziggs in the back of my mind, but I'd rather sort of keep them there and not out in the pond. Something I'd noticed, a lot of the guys on here weren't fishing the car park swim, or I hadn't seen anyone fish the car park swim whatsoever. A lot of the guys they're sort of doing overnighters here, and you would expect them to be fishing, you know, close to the car park, but a lot of them don't. You know, they go right the way round the other side of the lake, and you know, they fish well on here for them. Down to the left-hand side of the swim, you've got loads of snags in there. And about a month ago, I noticed that a couple of fish had turned up in them snags, and they're in a couple of foot of water in there. So I thought, right, is there any sort of way of fishing sort of for these fish? I was watching them and they're sort of taking these routes. They're obviously getting in and out of this area that you can't fish. So I'm keeping an eye on these fish, and a lot of them are going up to the right-hand side, and they're sitting under this bush that you can fish. Now, I've spoken to Tom, one of the lads that fishes on here a lot, and he said a lot of people just cast to that bush. It's 17 wraps out there, and just, yeah, wang it towards the bush as close as you can get it. But it's shallow all the way around to the margin. So I thought, right, you know what, I'm going to set up in here. I've got two lovely spots out in open water, and I'm going to wade up the margin. So I brought Littlen down. He's off school. So I brought Lewin with me. I've come down. I've waded off up this margin. And I've got the rod. And what I've done is basically all the trees go out into the lake, but they're all clear, all underneath them. You can see when you're on the bank and you're looking through the trees, there's nothing under them whatsoever other than clean gravel. So I've waded up there and just submerged the rod and stuck it right up underneath these trees, and like just basically placed the rig down. I can't see where I've placed it, but I know it's clear under there from seeing them from the bank, and just placed the rig under, taking the bail arm off, unslacking the rod, and just brought it back out. Thought, right, that, you know, that is just perfect. So I've basically put a rig probably where no one's ever put a rig before. So I've done that, settled down for the night, had a nice bit of food with Lewin. Next morning I've got up and it's eye pressure, the sun's beaming, you know, it just didn't look the one for carp fishing really. So I've gone back to bed. And as I've gone back to bed, I've nodded off, I've just like, diddy-dick, whack, something's like gone. I've shot out of the bivvy and the alarms have gone over, the backrest has come out of the floor and the rod's just arced right round. So I'm like, I've ran down, unstrapped the rod, leant into it, and this fish is going crazy.
Right, well, I'm into one. It tore off. It was the rod that I dropped over on them snags over there. So hasn't done a fish for weeks, this place. So I'm hoping and praying to God I can get this in. Oh, he's a nice looking common. Come on, darling, stop fighting. Stop fighting. Oh, here we go. It's a nice one. Angry. And yes, she's in. Yes. Oh, yes. Oh, sweet as a pea. Nice. Yes, well happy with that. Oh, mega. Yes. Got him, mate.
Another pit four common in the net, you know, just unbelievable.
What does it say then, mate? Yeah.
And then it was the first fish that Lewin had seen on the bank as well.
Happy, happy days. High five. Yes.
You know what? We had such a good time that session. It's just, you know, memories that live on forever, really. And I really, really cherish that session. But it wasn't over at that point either. I still had another night to go. Lewin was loving life as Lewin does. So I put the rod back underneath there. And then that evening, rod's gone again. I have got a little bit of footage on it, but it's all dark and gloomy. It's obviously getting into night time, but again, you know, another great fry on pit four, and another pit four common that went 24 pound. So that was my seventh fish on this venue. When I'd set out to catch three and now I've caught seven, I just, you know, well, I'm just amazed by it, to be honest with you. You know, it's been mental. And not only that, it hasn't done a fish for about 6 weeks either, other than them two that I'd had, which was only last week. So pretty much every swim that I have gone in, and I've fished quite a few of the swims on the lake now as well, I've pretty much fished all of them. So every single swim that I've gone in, I've swim mapped it. And I've actually been sharing swims with a friend that does overnights on here as well, and he's been sharing swims with me. And when I'd got into the car park swim, when I was down with Lewin, I got in there and my friend Tom, he knows I come down on a Sunday and Monday, always texts me, "How are you getting on, mate?" or "Where are you setting up?" And I said to him, I'm set up in the car park swim, and he's like, "Oh right, well here's the swim mapper app." I had Tatty Towel off of this spot, and I thought, "All right, nice." So I found, obviously I had my snag rod, my other rod, but the middle rod I was still yet to do. And he's like, "I've had Tatty Towel off of that spot." So I'm like, "Yes, game on, I'll put it straight out there." Well then, since the summer, things sort of continued for me in typical Pit 4 manner, where unfortunately I had a few blanks, but you know, that comes with a Pit 4 territory, I suppose. I knew in the back of my mind I had the Pit 3 winter ticket coming up, and I was desperate to try and catch another fish out of Pit 4, just to finish it off on what had already been an epic season for me on here. One day I turned up and everything seemed right. I turned up in a swim called Hole in the Trees. I'm looking out and there was fish everywhere in there, and they're bubbling up. The weather was perfect, so it was sort of like that dreary and a little bit of rain, and it just felt really atmospheric. Got the leading rod out, completely ruined it, totally wrecked the swim. I couldn't find a spot in there, and I weren't happy at all. And unfortunately, the fish just pushed out to the left of me, and I totally ruined it. And I sort of chucked the rods out pretty much anywhere after getting the right ump of having a lead round, sat in the bivvy, just annoyed with myself that I'd completely ruined it, which was probably going to be one of my last opportunities to catch a fish out of pit four. Probably think, well, why didn't you move with her? But there was a guy set up to my left, and the way the sun comes up in the morning, he wouldn't have been able to see where the fish had pushed out. So I'm sat out in the swim and I'm seeing him out in front of this guy next door, and the next minute he's walking up the path with his barrow, and I'm like, "Oh right, you're going?" And he's like, "Yeah mate, yeah, I've not seen anything." I thought, right, that's it, I'm gonna move. So with that, the Evans opened up, and what has probably been the most horrific move in my life, it's one of them, you know, where you set up in a swim next door, it's about 30 yards, 40 yards away, but you can't be bothered to put the bivvy down. You're walking with a bivvy and it's in the bushes like this, and it's just carnage everywhere. And it was the worst move in my life. And I've set up in a swim, I'm soaking wet, just thinking, what am I doing? I'm probably about to wreck this swim as well, because I've never leaded up or had a go in this swim either. So with that, I've got all my kit sorted out, I've had a cup of tea, I've sorted my life out, I thought, right, fish this properly now, don't ruin it for a second time. Gone out into the pond, into my waders, and I've found this spot, like, just out of complete luck. A real tiny spot, sort of found it first time, and I thought, that's probably quite a big area. And I struggled to find it again, but I didn't want to ruin it. I've marked it up with the horizon markers in the background, thought I'll just find it with a rod. Got two rods out on the spot, and I'm feeling lucky, you know. Next morning's turn up, I'm sort of looking out across the lake, and it just looked perfect for it. And you get them moments where you're just like, I know something's going to happen here, I know something's going to happen. I'm staring out in the water at the spot, and all of a sudden, this massive explosions happened on the lake, and where the lake was that still, it almost looked like it had dropped as I'm looking out at the spot. Didn't even hear the rod going or anything, and I'm just focused on this big sort of vortex, massive explosion, fishbacks come out of the water and then sort of kited left. And like, I must have been in this trance looking at this fish, because I've looked at the rod and the rod's going whoa, and I'm just sat there just like thinking, oh god. So I'm like, sort of ran out, it into this fish, and it's proper going left. And then I've ended up running up to the left-hand side of the bank, and I'm sort of running through the water like some div off of Baywatch, and it's just water going everywhere. And then I've ended up getting control of this fish. You know, all a little bit blurry, and you know, a lot of panic over me, but I managed to get him in the net, and what a fish that was. Right, well, after having a little run of bad luck over on Pit 4, it's all ended with this absolute belter. Oh,
proper blown away with this one. A real crazy battle with him as well. I was looking back at the bivvy, trying to get the video glasses, but this fish had other ideas. 33 pound and an ounce he went, and I couldn't be more happy. I actually moved swims for this fish as well, so all that hard work and trauma of moving in the rain has paid off for me nicely with this belter.
One more trip to go, so got back in the same swim, got the rods back out on the same spot, got the phone in my hand, I'm like, oh, it's going to happen this morning, mate, it's definitely going to happen. And then I've had a bream bite, I'm like, go, I've like, had this bream, but I'm like, oh, it's a bream. So I've leant into the rod and it's sort of coming towards me and I'm sort of cursing it, thinking, oh, it pops in bream. So reeling. All of a sudden it's tried to give a bit of line, I'm like, oh, maybe it is a carp. And I've walked out in the pond, and I've like, before even knowing it, I'm right out there, sort of like right up to the chest waders. I'm looking out and this fish is sort of fighting around in front of me and I'm thinking, nah, it's just a crazy bream. And all of a sudden this massive patch of scales come up. I'm like, oh God, it's fully. And I'm like looking back at the swim and it must have been sort of, well, it looked like miles, but it was probably only about 10, 20 yards away. The net just leaning up against the trees. And I'm like, oh, why didn't I come out with the net? So I'm sort of like giving this fish line, I can't believe it's a carp. And I'm walking back, got the net. He's come out, this beautiful patch of scales come up in the net. Last session, last fish, and it was a proper epic looking fully.
What an immense looking creature this one is. Ah. Proper blown away with him. He is an absolute belter. 26 pound 4 ounces he went, and only about 10 or 15 minutes of putting the rod back out from catching a bream did he rattle off. Hence why I thought it was another bream, but to my surprise it wasn't. It was this beautiful scaly pit four one. Yes.
In my angling, it's weird because whenever I start on syndicates, if I catch one on the first night, I normally always have a really good year. And I caught one that first night and I just knew within me that, you know, perhaps pit four's gonna be kind to me this year. And yeah, it was more than kind to me. You know, I think I ended up banking 9 fish in the end out of pit four. And I've loved every minute of it, you know, and yeah, I didn't expect to sort of be fishing it again this season, and I'm really looking forward to it. I've already paid for my ticket, so yeah, my ticket's been bought well in advance, and yeah, I'm really looking forward to the year ahead. And yeah, it's been a real special lake to me, and I've shared some magical moments with my boy on here as well, which is you know, really special to me. So yeah, it's been mega, mega kind, and yeah, I'm looking forward to the future on Pit 4, that's for sure.
Next up is Harry Charrington, who's out on the bank for a day with England manager and Fox's resident underwater expert, Rob Hughes. Harry's got some questions for Rob, but he isn't going to get comprehensive answers unless Rob gets his diving kit on.
I'm en route to meet up with underwater expert, my Team England manager and general all-round carp angling legend, Rob Hughes, to do a bit of below the surface underwater tests. Now, it's not going to be quite the same as how we've done it in the past, whereby one of our anglers goes and fishes how they would do in a normal session, finds a spot, put the rods out, and Rob goes to see how well they've done. We're going to be investigating one tactic in as much detail as we possibly can, and that tactic is chod rig fishing. Now, I've got quite a lot of questions that I'd like answering about chod rig fishing. Personally, I haven't done a lot of it for probably the last 9 or 10 years. I have fished it before, but I've found it to be inconsistent at best in my fishing. And I think a lot of other people's fishing as well. A lot of people catch a lot of good fish on it, but also a lot of people struggle to get it right. And I think I'm one of them without doubt. So I've got a lot of questions that I want to ask Rob. Rob's fished a lot of Chod Rigs in the past and caught a lot of good fish on them. So I'm sure he's got some wisdom to impart, and also he's going to have his snorkel with him, and he's going to go and have a look at a load of different presentations. Yeah, hopefully it'll enlighten me and enlighten you guys. So let's see.
That landing net's going to fall over on the camera.
I am going to move that.
Yeah, move that, because that will fall over on the camera.
Oh, it's exciting.
Hey, Robert.
Yes.
So nice to see you.
Absolutely, on this lovely autumnal day with sticks falling and wind blowing and planes flying.
Yes, right. Chod Rigs is what we've come to talk about.
Absolutely.
It's not going to be your usual below the surface style dive that you normally do. We're not going to go out and find a specific spot because we're looking at Chod Rigs, and they are the ultimate chuck it anywhere type thing. That's what they build at.
Mythbuster alert straight away. You know, a lot of people think they are, but they're not. A lot of people say they're a lazy man's rig, and they're not. You know, there's a lot more to Chod Rigs than just slinging them out and thinking you're going to catch a carp on them. And I think the first thing I'd say is be very, very careful about that. You can chuck it anywhere. It's not quite a 4x4.
Yeah, I agree. That's part of the reason that I tend to shy away from them, because a lot of people, just chuck a choddy out there. And personally, I'd much rather spend time to find a spot and that sort of thing. But I think if you already know what's out there, you can tailor your Chod Rig and make it suit.
Like anything, there is always a time for a certain type of rig. And anybody that thinks this is the rig that I will use all the time is making a mistake, because there'll be times where that rig isn't the best rig that you should use. And it's exactly the same with the choddy. You know, just thinking you can chuck a choddy out anywhere, no, mistake. Never ever thinking that there's a suitable time for one, another mistake. And you know, let's have a look at a situation where if you find a load of fish and you've got one chance, but you don't know what's underneath them. So you know, they might be over the top of weed, they might be in an area that's shallow, they might be in an area where you haven't got the opportunity to either chuck a marker rod out or have two or three casts. You've just got one quick go to get a rig in there, then a choddy can work on that. And I'm not saying it always does, but it can work in that situation.
Yeah, well, I haven't had an awful lot of experience with them. I'm going to hold my hands up. I am a choddy noddy. But you've
see
what
had you did there.
It's quite good actually. You've had quite a lot more experience than I have.
Yeah, it's not something that I dive for all the time, and I must say that my fishing evolves according to wherever I'm fishing lake-wise. And certainly I'm not the sort of guy that's got a choddy always ready to rock and roll, because it isn't necessarily the one that I will reach for first. But if I'm on a lake that suits it, then I will. And I can think of two seasons in particular where I used them to very, very good effect. One was on a Colne Valley lake, and I'm not going to name for the sake of the guys that are in there, but there were crayfish in it, and the crays found it very, very difficult to deal with the chod.
Yeah.
It was brilliant that you could get round the crayfish a little bit, but also at the same time, the fish, Colne Valley, it's always seen a lot of pressure, and I caught the majority of the big fish in the lake very, very quickly, all on the chod. And by the end of the season, most of the other lads that were fishing there were all on the chod as well. I say by the end of the season, most of them were on it very, very quickly. And if you're watching this, Mr. Bailiff, I remember you coming around and rig checking me, and lo and behold, you changed your rigs afterwards, and I look you straight in the eye when I say that. Anyway, so, you know, loads of people were on there. The other one is a lake that many, many people know, and that's Wellington Country Park.
Yeah.
And when I fished there, it was a few years ago, it was starting to get famous. And it's a very shallow lake. There's an awful lot of weed there. And the fish don't just feed on the clear spots. And the ability to be able to present over big beds of weed allowed me to catch an awful lot of the fish in there, again, pretty quickly. And we all have lakes that are very kind to us, and Wellington was one that was very, very kind to me in the very short period of time that I fished it. And that was purely down to Chod Rig.
Yeah. Okay, well...
He's convince me. It's convince Harry time.
Right, give me the Chod. No, I'm quite excited to actually see, take a decent in-depth look at these underwater. I'm very, very happy that you've agreed to come out and dive over these Chod rigs that I'm going to be flinging about. I think you better get your kit on and let's get to it.
Happy days.
So what exactly is a Chod rig? It's essentially a very short hook length fished directly on the mainline or leader, helicopter style. It's designed to be fished up the line as opposed to below the lead to keep the hook away from the lead. In theory, this stops the hook getting snarled up in weed or rubbish on the bottom. The hook link itself is very short and made from stiff monofilament. Being so stiff, it allows it to be curved aggressively, and this enhances its hooking efficiency. The hook size can vary according to bait size, but it needs to be a stiff rig style hook with an outturned eye. The hook is attached to the mono in a D rig style, and the bait is threaded onto a micro hook ring swivel onto the D to allow plenty of movement. Leader material can vary, and there are usually three options: lead core for tough situations where you want to get the rig down quickly, or where you need ultimate abrasion resistance. Submerge, which is a leadless supple material which sinks quickly and is perfect for undulating lake beds. And then finally there's naked, which is fished straight on nylon and preferably Illusion Trans Khaki fluorocarbon. This is great for clear water or where you're fishing over weed. The lead is attached to the end of the line or leader using a quick change clip covered by a buffer sleeve. All the individual beads and components are available separately, or you can get everything in a kit. You can also get perfect pre-tied chods too.
Well, Harry's just chucked out three different chod setups, more or less to the same spot out there, and he's done more or less exactly what most people will do when they're chod fishing. Spot a spot, chuck it out there, happy days. Now, before we go into any tests, experiments, opinions, or investigation in any way, shape, or form, the first thing we need to do is just go out, have a look at them, and see exactly how they're lying. As I dip into the waters off Thorpley, we can see the pop up there standing out pretty well. That's nice, bright and pink, but just look at the spot it's over. Part of the reason we came here was because we thought there was lots of chod and the perfect environment for a chod rig. And look at this, the first cast out and it's landed on a clear spot. But whilst it's not necessarily the sort of place that you would normally fish a chod, it does give you a great indication as to what it looks like when it's cast out. Obviously, if you're fishing over something like this, normally you'd stick a bottom bait out or something that's a little bit lower to the deck itself. And we'll close in now, just have a look at that. You can see it's sitting fairly high off the deck, hence the reason that maybe a wafter or a bottom bait would be better. But let's just have a look at that leader. Look how well that blends in, and it shows that we've got our colours absolutely cock on. This is the second rig now, and just look at the difference in that bottom. This was cast probably only 3 yards away from the other one, and it goes to show that the bottom can be very, very different only just a short period away. A lot of weed on the deck here, mixture of various different types, a little bit of Canadian, but quite a lot of like blankety weed style stuff really, a few dead leaves there, and you can see the pop-up and the choddy sitting absolutely perfect on top. The lead is fairly tight there. That's been cast in, laid down over the top, and it's presented very, very well. And as we look just towards the back end, the lead will be buried in that big pile of weed there. But nevertheless, the rig is still pretty well presented. Just moving back up towards the chod itself, and you can see that it's sat by the bead. And that's because when it was cast in, it was allowed to drill its way forwards. And here's the third one, and initially you might wonder what on earth you're looking at, but if you look just to the right hand side of the shot, you'll see a bead creep in. There it is. This is a naked chod.
and we're using the Illusion Transkhaki fluorocarbon. My finger's just coming in there to help you see it, and as we look back up now, you can just about make out where it is, and probably didn't see that before. But it's a really, really good choice when you're fishing over weed like this, because it's not as heavy as the other materials, doesn't dig in, and lifts off a lot easier as well. Chod sitting perfectly, just as it should do, and the lead, well, that will be buried just a little bit further back in that weed. That was three really interesting examples of chod rigs in situ. And let's have a look at the different styles of them first. You know, for me, the winner without any shadow of doubt was the Transkhaki fluorocarbon. It was nigh on impossible to see, and it also presented itself really, really well on top of that weed. Didn't dig in, so if there's weed around, that's going to be the choice for me, really. You know, the other thing that we've got to think of is that all three were actually really well presented, which is great because it is quite nasty down there. But I've got a bit of a word of warning for you. A lot of people fish a chod without the bottom bead. They don't fix it in place. And the problem comes when you cast out, because under our normal rule book, we cast out, we clip it or stop it, and we feel it down. But think about the science of it. As soon as you break it, that chod is going to fly back towards the lead and be dragged into the weed. And that's when you can get problems. So the rule book's almost got to be ripped up if you're fishing a choddy without a bottom bead on it. When you cast out, stop it more or less where you want it to be, but then immediately let it go again. And what will happen is as it flies through the air, the chod will go down towards the lead and then pull away again. Because if it dives in and it's being stopped, your rig is going to be dragged into the weed, and you absolutely don't want that. Now, this is what happens when you hit the clip and feel it down using a sliding chod. The rig will move all the way down towards the lead end rather than staying a little bit further away, and that lead will pull it into the weed. Just have a look at this now. We saw this rig cast out before where it was cast in a different style and it sat perfectly, but now when it's hit the clip and dropped down with the lead, it's not really presented as well as it could be. That lead's pulling it into the weed. So let's have a practical example of this on the bank. This is the exact rig that Harry's just cast out. You can see lovely, neat setup, and it's running. Brilliant when you're playing a fish, because when the fish picks the bait up and hooks itself, what's going to happen is it will slide down. The easier it can slide down, the better it is for me for keeping that fish on. And down at the bottom, remember, this is where the pressure is during the course of the fight. And this is a chod heli buffer sleeve, and it's got a nice little tail on the top there that protects the line from the swivel, and also everything's tucked in at the bottom end to keep it very neat. But let's have a look at the casting situation. It's going through the air. If we stop it, what will happen is that will fly forwards and it will sink on that tight line like so. Now that's going to drag it into the weed, which is a little bit of a problem. So to solve that, what we need to do is try and keep it up there, or alternatively change the casting style. So if it stays away from the lead, it's not going to fall in. We do have a solution for you. Here is one we made earlier, and this is the tungsten chod bead kit, micro tungsten chod bead kit in fact, because it is small and really, really neat. And this is the area of magic. It's basically two beads that push together on a stem that protects the line underneath. And I can't emphasize enough how important it is to protect the line, because when you're pulling sideways on it, that can cause damage. So when you've got these bead systems, that line is nice and safe. And it's secured in place. It will slide under pressure, but under the cast it won't. And you can set that wherever you want to. So there, it's 18 odd inches away. And if you cast in, hit the clip and drop it back down on a tight line, that is not going to pull down towards the lead, but it will during the course of a fight, because the pressure of the fish will pull it back down there. And at the buffer sleeve at the other end, there's an indent in there, so everything sits in really, really neatly. So it's a very tidy, neat, purpose-designed setup for fishing a chod in a semi-fixed way, away from the lead. Now, whenever you fish any rig at all, of course, you've got to look at safety, so just be aware of knots above the line, but that will pop off, slide up nice and easily, and that will disappear. if there is a problem. So really the choice is up to you, and you've got to decide from your casting style which rig suits you best. If you drill it in, running is not a problem. If you want to hit the clip and feel what you're fishing over, this is definitely a better solution. Look at a few other problems with chod rigs as well now. And a few years ago, chods were the things to use. Loads and loads of people were using them, and I was diving over a lot of people and just looking at them in various different situations. They sort of became known as a bit of a cast it anywhere rig and you'll be all right with it. That simply isn't the case. You've still got to think quite a lot about where you're fishing. And one of the big ones is the biggest problem we face a lot of the time when we're out, particularly in the summer, and that's weed. Now, Canadian pondweed can cause some serious problems. Obviously, for a start, it's very, very thick, very deep. So if you are fishing with a choddy around about Canadian pondweed, the first thing that you've got to establish is exactly how deep is it. Chuck a grappling lead out there, grab some back, and if you think the weed is 2 foot deep, add at least 50% for your top bead on your chod. So 2 foot, you need it to be set at 3 foot. 4 foot of weed, you need to set it at 6 foot. 8 foot of weed, probably shouldn't really be fishing there, but if you are going to, you've got to go really, really light, and that's when you're getting into balancing it off with foam and so on and so forth. But really, bog standard rule of thumb, when you know how deep the weed is, add at least 50% for your bead setting. Another big problem is line angles, and remember that because the chod itself is sitting on the rod end as opposed to behind the lead, it's going to be on the angle between where the lead and the rod tip is. It's not on the other side of it. So if you're fishing over the back of something, particularly a big weed bed, you know, you cast out, you know there's a weed bed there, you go over the back of the weed bed, your line's going to be doing that. Now the chod could be somewhere up in the air and you're almost going to be fishing a zig rig. So really, really think about what you're fishing over. And this is a bog standard rule for whenever you're going carping, even though, and again with a choddy, you can use it as a quick hit tactic, you can fall foul of yourself if you don't know what the deck's like underneath. So for me, I really struggle if I don't know what's on the bottom, because if I'm fishing over the top of something like that and it's up in the air, your presentation's going to be really daft. And finally, one of the biggest problems with any rig, but particularly with a chod rig, is filamentous algae. Filamentous algae really can be a nightmare, and just as we close in onto this rig, you'll see exactly what I mean. Some people call it blanket weed, but there is a big difference between blanket weed and filamentous algae. Just have a look there and you can see the really light candy flossy style stuff. That is filamentous algae, and it doesn't sit directly on the bottom. It sits just off it and it moves around. And you can see there the rig is just behind that curtain of filamentous algae. It's sitting on what we would see as blanket weed. And as the water moves through the course of its just natural behavior, that weed moves with it. So you can actually chuck out and the rig can be presented perfectly, but this stuff can move around. And just watch here now, I pull it back. You can see that the rig is perfectly presented underneath, but if that weed is moving around, it can mask the hook and cause you problems. And it's really, really difficult to get around. If you were fishing a normal rig, it will be absolutely dead in that. No chance of catching anything at all, other than maybe with a massive PVA bag. And here's almost exactly the opposite sort of problem now, a chod on a big clear area. And there's a lot of weed around, and it would be normally the sort of place that you could fish a chod, but if you land on one of the clean spots within these areas, then sometimes it can stand out a little bit too much. And really, if you're finding it cracked down, you need to be fishing on the deck, possibly with a bag or certainly a bottom bait. But just look at that. See the lead core there? You can see it's pretty stiff. Where you're fishing on an uneven bottom and it's a little bit stony, that can come off the deck a little bit. And in that situation with the leader, it might be better to use something like a supple submerge, which would sit and hug the contours a bit more. Colour's good on the lead core though, but just look as we move right, that horrible floating candy floss cloud again. And this is the sort of thing that really does cause problems. If we've got a bottom bait on there, there's much less chance of that snagging up, but we can see perfectly there how it's just floating around. And my movements in the water, that's going to move that around a little bit more, but it does that naturally. And if you've got a big pop-up coming off the deck, that can cause you problems there. One area you've got to be particularly careful of when you're fishing a choddy is knowing what's on the bottom and what the bottom topography is like. So let's just use a practical example. Behind me there's an island. Fishing up against that is going to be absolutely fantastic. The fish are going to be moving back and to along the front of it, and there's going to be a lovely drop off coming off there that will be undoubtedly a fish patrol route. However, when you're using a chod, just remember that the hook is on the rod side, not the lead side. So as it's come back again, it's going to be away from the lead. If the angle of the bank is dropping away like so, the lead's going to be here. The hook could be somewhere off the deck, and that's not what you want. I've seen that a number of times, both with regards to island margins, also with regards to gravel bars, plateaus, drop-offs. Just have a think about what you're fishing over. The best place to fish a choddy is on something that's flat, not something that's dropping back towards you. Let's have a look at an underwater example of exactly that. And you can see here, the chod's been cast up to the island margin. The lead's landed up the shelf, but the hook and the chod rig itself has actually slipped further back down, where it should do, of course, down towards the bead, but it's not on the deck. And a lot of the time on island slopes, towards the bottom, there isn't that much weed. So you can see there, it's fishing almost like a zig rig rather than a choddy itself. Now, presentation is absolutely nothing without indication. All very well getting a pickup. If you don't know about it, particularly in weedy areas, it can drop you, do you, get rid of you, and you'll never even know that you've had a bite. So what's the best way to fish a chod? The majority of people will tell you to fish choddies slack. To a degree, that's right. But in a moment, what we're going to do is we're going to put that to the test at normal chod range, 30 odd yards out, and we're going to see whether a semi-slack or a full slack is the best presentation. What I will say is standard sort of rules apply as well. If you're going long, then you can afford to be slightly tighter. Remember, choddies give pretty good indication because the hook, once again, is on the rod side rather than the lead side of the rig. So you will get quite a few twitches, and when you're fishing slack, you're going to get more liner indication as well. But generally what I've found is that when they go, they go. Well, that was pretty good, and we're fishing at normal choddy range, sort of 30 odd yards, fairly slack here, a lot of stuff on the deck, but fluorocarbon does make a massive, massive difference on that, and I've seen this in numerous tests everywhere, that if you're fishing with fluorocarbon, your indication is going to be better than standard nylon. However, if you thought that was good, just have a look at this. This is incredible. Well, that was just absolutely incredible, and that was semi-slack as opposed to fully slack. So just push the boundaries a little bit, break with convention, don't do what everybody tells you to do just because they've told you to do it. Think about it. And I've got to say, that is probably one of the best, if not the best, indications I've ever seen in all the tests that I've done. Now, fair dues, it was fairly short. It's only 30 or so yards out, but that fluorocarbon makes a massive difference. And the indication there was probably as good as I've seen fishing tight line with springers. So if you're in this sort of situation, fairly short range chod work, my word, get that fluorocarbon on. That makes a massive difference.
Rob, that was pretty eye-opening, I have to say. I'm surprised at how well most of the time they were presented. It does seem like the sort of ideal time of year, the ideal area for chod rigs, but I was still impressed. Yeah, I have to say.
It's quite surprising where you can put them, isn't it?
Yeah.
And how quickly you can put them as well.
They're a lot more versatile than I originally thought, and that indication just blew my mind.
I think for me, that's blown my mind because I've not done as good an indication test as that ever, anywhere. It's weighted a little bit towards its favour because it's fairly short range, but irrespective of that, it's still genuinely better than anything I've seen before.
Yeah, I'd completely agree with that. I thought that the indication on chod rigs would be worse than anything else, but it's better. Like you say, the fact that the hook is the rod side of the lead, you've got that much extra sort of angle of pull. Well,
think about it simply, the lead doesn't have to move to give you indication. And if the lead doesn't have to move, then that's massive. Obviously, the slacker you go, the worse that indication is going to be. The further out you go, the worse that indication is going to be. But actually, if you think about feeder anglers, a lot of the time they'll use paternosters. They're using tiny little tips. They're fishing up to sort of 50, 60 yards, and they're feeling the tiniest little bit of twitches. And that's, once again, because the lead doesn't have to move. And that's massive.
Yeah, yeah. I know there's definitely a few situations now in my own fishing. There's one water that I fish where they like their boilies and they don't like being cast out a lot.
That's perfect.
And I think I might, especially this time of year, I might sneak the odd chod rig into my fishing.
Well, it was made for this time of year, and I think, we've looked at some very good ways of fishing it. We've looked at where you can present it. We've looked at the problems. But the key to all of this, as with any bit of your angling, is you need to be open-minded. Don't just always go for whatever your default setting is, because we've all got that default setting. We all like to fish that. I'm the same, you're the same. We've all got something that we like to do. But normally the battleground will tell us what to do. And if we think about what's out there a little bit more and apply our minds a little bit wider, almost certainly we'll catch more fish.
Rob, you've been a star. Cheers, man.
Some very, very interesting findings there from Rob and Harry, and certainly gives us some food for thought if you're considering using chod rigs. Back in October, Fox asked me if I'd like to fly to Romania and catch some carp, and as you can imagine, I jumped at the opportunity, and here's what happened. A few days ago, I boarded a flight from Stansted Airport bound for Bucharest in Romania.
I love it. I hate flying. No power, so you can get my microphone.
Yeah, they do.
It's a microphone. It's 32,000 feet. I've actually left an aircraft in this flight, but I wasn't that frightened because I had a parachute on. I'm frightened now because I have
a it was a country that I hadn't visited for 13 years, and it is a remarkable country with some remarkable carp fishing history. Back in the late 80s and through much of the 90s, Lake Reduta in Romania was producing some absolutely enormous fish. Many people flew over here from around the world. Lots and lots of guys from England went over, and the lake itself produced a world record back in the day, which is interestingly a mirror in a country that's dominated a lot by commons. And it really made a name for itself and put itself on the map. And once we touched down at Bucharest, we were met by Fox's main man in Romania, Andre, and driven to this wonderful lake called Tincabesti, not 20 minutes from the airfield. It's about 120 acres. It's a stunning place. And we'll probably get around to telling you a bit more about the floating islands later, but there's a few of those dotted around the place. It's got a great history, and it's a lake that is getting better and better as the years go by. It's got a lake record of about 52 pound, and there were fish in here that would certainly beat my Romanian personal best from 2003, which was 33 pound. Caught in a match in which myself and Keith Jenkins came fourth in the World Championships, which was kind of pleasing. One of the most amusing and memorable things that happened here was when we arrived in the first swim. And there, asleep on a very, very old and tatty unhooking mat, were two tiny little black and brown puppies. They were incredible. They came up, they loved it. They were running around our feet. They were absolutely incredible and so much fun. I think Englishmen and dogs, you know, we're sort of notorious worldwide for loving them. Unfortunately, the owner of the lake thought they'd get in our way, and a few hours later he bundled them into his car and took them back up towards the hotel. But yeah, I think I would have liked them to stick around for a little while, at least in all that appalling weather, they might have put a smile on our face. On arrival at the lake, Andre pointed out a few things, and a couple of his mates were here too, and there was lots of advice flying around everywhere. I'm not the greatest person for following advice or fashions for that matter, and quite like to do my own thing. I was told that pop-ups didn't work on here, so the first thing I tied on was three stiff link pop-ups onto the rods. I've got an inflatable boat available to me with an engine on, which makes life a whole lot easier. Unfortunately, there was a very, very unusual wind blowing from the northeast. And whilst the sun was shining initially, things were just about to change very, very rapidly indeed. Positioning the hook baits was really, really difficult too. I fished two of the spots that they recommended. Didn't put loads of bait out, a couple of kilos around each one. And I found a third spot that I kind of like, but I found a relatively clear area up alongside the island, the floating island, and I put a hook bait there. It's actually pretty cold. It is hammering down with rain. I have absolutely no idea what the time is, and I'm playing my first carp of the trip. Remarkable. The rain hasn't stopped for hours, and doesn't look like it's going to either, but as bad as the weather is, the fishing looks like it's pretty good. It's like an outdoor skating rink here. Wow. I'll continue to smile. It doesn't matter what the weather does. Although I am absolutely freezing and shivering. That's a carp in my landing net. So let me just warm up a second and we'll take a look at it. If it looks a little awkward, it's because it is. It's so slippy. Okay. If he, it looks like a he, will allow me, I'll hold up my first Romanian carp of around 20 pound for 13 years. Incredible. The weather has got steadily worse and worse and worse. It gets to a point sometimes when you're looking at the rods, telling them to hang on till you get a break in the rain, but to be honest with you, I wouldn't have it any other way. What a fantastic fish, and hopefully the start of good things to come. It rained, it just didn't stop. We got wetter and wetter and wetter. The ground was like a quagmire and it was difficult. One of the biggest problems I've got is I'm an ex-paratrooper and I operate on the absolute bare minimum of anything. So packing for this particular trip, I was just what I normally do, take the minimum necessary. In my rod tube, I put three rods, three buzzers, a landing net, a couple of spare shirts, and my waterproofs, a few other odds and ends to make life a little bit easier on the bank. In my barra bag, again, some spare clothing. And one of the biggest things for me are the hook baits that I use. I can use all kinds of bait, any kind of baits, but I need my pineapple pop-ups, I need my hybrid pop-ups, and I need my little toppers. And some dips to dip them in. So I brought some of that along. My tackle box that I use everywhere is the tackle box that I brought here. I put that in my flight bag. I was going to tie some rigs on the plane and never got around to it. I brought a few kilos of the impact boilies from Mainline just to try and jazz up the baited area, and I think it worked. And that was about it, really. The brollies and the bed chairs, sleeping bags were here, along with an unhooking mat and all the stuff to look after the fish. But I have to say, the biggest schoolboy error I've ever made in my life was not to bring any tea bags. And thankfully, the man behind the camera, Harry Charrington, brought some PG tips, and I will never ever be able to thank him enough for that. It's very Spartan, and in the conditions we've had to suffer, yes, it has been at times incredibly uncomfortable, but I always believe it's things like that that add to the experience, and the experience I've had in Romania has been absolutely fantastic. What follows in military parlance is a short sit rep. This is my second day in Romania. It's mid-morning. I got the rods out yesterday in beautiful sunshine, round about 4 o'clock in the evening. I haven't been fishing for that long, and as much as I always want to accentuate the positive. So I've had one fish of round about 20 pounds, and I've lost one. The one that I landed was in the middle of the night, and shortly after I got the rods in yesterday, it started to hammer down. The wind has picked up and increased steadily through the night, and I have to say, whilst I don't want to put a dampener on anything when I'm carp fishing, it is absolutely horrible here. And I may look like I'm doing a bit of summer fishing in my shorts and my sandals, but my clothing is suitably wet, and if I do get another bite, all that's going to happen to the dry clothing I put on is that's going to get wet too. So as a typical soldier, I'll let my body heat dry it out. It's a very, very interesting lake. It's got an awful lot of carp, and they probably don't know how many carp are in here. And I've got three rods out there fishing in very likely looking areas. But what the most strange thing about the whole situation is where my three rods are around a floating island. It drifts around the lake, certainly in high wind conditions, which this is becoming, and there's every likelihood that in a few hours the island that's out there about 80 yards could be half a mile down the other end of the lake. How weird is that? limited, of course, by what we could carry out here. We needed some help in-house. And a Romanian guy called Chippy has provided all the bait we'll need. He's brought us down two different kinds of boilies, which have been great. And they are obviously baits that these fish are seeing regularly. And yeah, it doesn't get much better than that. There are also some bags of particles, maize and barley, some pellets, and all the hook baits and dips that I would ever need. It's been so helpful, and obviously, at a time when this lake is fishing so poorly, they've come up trumped and helped us to land some carp, and we most certainly haven't wasted our time. Thanks very much to Chippy. This, my friends, is absolute insanity. I don't know how else to put it. How much do you want to catch a carp? I've come all this way, so there's no point coming here without putting the effort in. But yeah, this is completely and utterly bonkers. There, I've said it. A little update. I'm a bit fed up with this swim, to be quite honest with you. You know, I've had a couple of bites, but I think it's time to move on. The conditions have been perfect for a while, and there's been no more action. And I'm afraid it's like any of the fishing that I'll do. If the carp aren't there to be caught, then they're going to be somewhere else. And it's up to me to go and find them. I'm going to get the rods in. We're going to have a little look down to our right. Actually, looks quite good in the lee of the island. The wind's still pumping down there. I would have thought there's fish there. Again, I don't know the lake, and it really is guesswork, but I'd rather be trying and failing than not trying at all, for want of a better phrase. So rods in, and let's get on the toes and see if we can catch something somewhere else. Now you're on your own, hope you feel the pain of your thoughts inside driving you insane. Now another love gone bad again, you're bad again. That you're on your own, hope you feel the pain of your thoughts inside driving you insane. Now another love gone bad again, you're bad again. Well, I'm glad that it's over, 'cause it can hurt anymore. What I did is I went out with the rod with the little grappling lead on it to go and have a nose along those reed lines along the floating islands. And as much as they go out there and bait up, I found very, very few spots that, to me, said that carp fed there. All of them were covered in all kinds of stuff on the bottom. Little twigs, dead reeds, no weed at all, but there's a lot of stuff there. I did fish on two of the spots in the first swim and caught from the spot that I found. And this swim was even better. I put two of the rods on the areas that they recommended, but I found another one. It was absolutely clean. Quite firm, but not totally firm, but certainly firmer than the other two spots I'd put a rod on. And I baited it up. And it doesn't matter if I've got an inflatable boat available to me here and whether I've got a cast out, go out in the boat or whatever. You still need to carry out the basics of carp fishing. It doesn't matter what rig you've got and what bait you've got. If you don't put it in the right place, you are not going to get a bite. However easy a boat makes the fishing, and although it hasn't been easy here with the boat at all. Right. I've made a move. I've come up to the right of the swim we were in, probably about 150, 200 metres. And basically, I am fishing, it looks like a far margin, but it's not. It's other floating islands that have butted up against the far bank. So I'm fishing in a very similar way. I've changed over to bottom baits. One of the local guys thinks that's the only way to catch them out of here. So I'm going to follow fashion for once in my life. I haven't put loads of bait out, and hopefully the carp are going to come back in here. It's going to get quite a bit warmer and sunnier tomorrow. It's quite a shallow bay, and hopefully they'll do what carp do around the world and come in and make the most of it before winter sets in. One of the best things that's happened, though, since we've been here, the restaurant at Tinker Bestie has provided us with the most fantastic fish platter. And I cannot, well, I've never seen Bivvy Tucker get any better than that. So without further ado, I'm going to tuck in, and hopefully the carp will do the same a little later on. I don't think I've ever been so nervous about playing a carp. This has been such a difficult session in a totally unknown environment. And I went and found my own little spot in the what they call the channels in between these floating islands, and it's that rod that's gone. Amazing. It's 250 yards out, so I'll be a while reeling it in. I've moved up onto the high ground. Evidently there are a few little snags out here. Right, I'm gonna get down a little bit nearer my rods without falling over. Now I'm in direct contact again. It feels a little bit heavier, but like I say, I don't care. We've been absolutely soaked to the skin now for, I don't know, 40 hours or something. Crazy. What's a mirror? Oh, I'm chuffed to pieces. I have never caught a mirror in Romania. How wonderful. Feisty mirror, who is now in the bottom of my landing net. Wow. Yes. The greatest part of that is it's from a, I was determined for one of the rods to be on a spot that nobody else had talked about. And well, the first bite in a new swim, there he is. What an absolute belter. Yeah. Cool. Okay. Settle down now. Stunning carp. £17-18 I would have thought, and I really, really don't care. Wherever I am on this planet, if I can catch mirror carp that look like that, I will be a very, very happy man. I say this is my second trip to Romania. The other one was 13 whole years ago, and we did catch a few commons out of Reduta, but I never had a mirror carp from here. So this is my first one, and what a spectacular carp to do it with. Interestingly, as I said, when I was playing the fish, I'd had all that advice, but unfortunately, I'm one of those people who got to go and prove things to myself. So I found my own little spot, and it seemed absolutely perfect. And 2 hours later, I'm holding my first carp after the move, and I don't think I need a better confirmation than that. Okay, we're out in the boat, to redo that rod after that cracking little mirror. Not the biggest fish in the world, but what a spectacular fish. Right, the rig itself. One of our new size 5 hooks, absolutely fantastic. A long hair, you can see that dangling down below with a little mainline topper on top. I do like those little fellas just to put a bit of buoyancy into the hook bait. And I call it the Nobby Styles, the Piles rig. Just 3 boilies threaded down the hook link and push the hook through one of the exposed sections. It's just an ideal way of putting boilies out. 4-ounce lead and a lead clip. And that is what's going out. And that is back on the money. Sneaky feeling this is a much bigger fish than we've been used to. Oh, there it is, and it is a common this time. Not a bad one either. It's quite amazing how much this wind's got up. Once the cloud had cleared, I thought it would be a still and pleasant evening, but it's nothing of the sort. It's an incredibly windy night, and as soon as you put that rod up, you can feel the wind dragging on the line. This fish is just still absolutely full of life. It's quite amazing. I'll get it up on the surface, but good fish, goodness gracious. Wow, a little bit of perseverance and some bloody mindedness, that is a very big common. I don't know if you can see in the darkness, but take a look at the width of that across the back. Oh, big animal. Right, excuse me while I put my rod down and take a few deep breaths. That was we have tried so hard in the most adverse of conditions, and I can't tell you how pleased I am about that. There has to be a little bit of light and fires, I think, and I hope I can get a little bit more, because it's absolutely Yes! Wow! That is a big animal. Wow. Oh, dearie me. Oh, look at that. Oh my goodness gracious me. That is absolutely perfect. Oh, hang on a second. Let's get this round here. I'm gonna say £41. Absolutely awesome. Well, that's exactly what I came here to catch, and I cannot tell you how pleased I am. And it is an absolutely immaculate fish. Dawn is just about to make an appearance in the sky, probably in an hour or so. So I'm going to put her in the retainer because I really want to do her justice in front of the camera in an hour or so's time. What a stunning fish, and I'm absolutely blown away. Incredible. When the guys at Fox told me I was off to Romania to do a little bit of fishing and a little bit of filming, two things sprang immediately to mind. I hadn't been to Romania for 13 years. And during that time, I'd fished a World Championship match. And whilst I was doing so, the second thing was I caught my personal best Romanian carp of 33 pounds. So the mission was to catch a carp bigger than that. And in the wee small early hours of this morning, oof, I did just that. This stunning 41 pound common came to visit, and it was a hell of a battle. All the fish that I have hooked seem to come in from range, but get within 20 yards of the bank and it's game on. Probably took me about 15 minutes from that point to get this in the bottom of my net. The conditions have been appalling. I've been confronted with conditions I've never had to face in my life. But steady application of bait and keep fighting against those conditions, and the rewards are there. Absolutely fantastic. And when you achieve targets like that, there really is nothing better in my carp fishing life. What an absolute cracker. Confidence is everything to me in fishing. If I've got confidence in the equipment that I'm using, the bait that I'm using, and the rigs that I'm using, then I've gone an awful long way to catching a carp. Probably for the past 25 years, whenever I'm fishing over a bed of bait on the bottom of the lake, however big or small that may be, I've only ever used two rigs. Yes, the components have changed slightly over the years, but the mechanics have remained exactly the same. They give me every confidence I will ever need. From the hardest lakes in the country to some of the more easy commercial venues, they've worked on all of them, and I've never, ever, ever found a need to change. The only thing I do change about them is my hook after every fish. That needs to be sharp. I don't sharpen my hooks, and I never will. I'll get a new one out of the packet. and so to this session in Romania. I started out this session using three stiff link pop-ups. And I am a little bit annoying at times. I'll do the complete opposite to what people tell me. And I was told that pop-ups really don't work on here. And the second bite I got, I actually landed at a £20 common, which proved my point quite nicely. Having proved to myself that I could catch on a stiff link pop-up from this remarkable Romanian lake, we moved swims shortly after that, and I switched over to my more normal bottom bait setup, a rig that I have used again on countless waters all around the country and around the world with great success. It's a very, very simple rig, but the mechanics are absolutely sound. The hook link material itself is camo text, dark camo, strippable braid. And the first thing I do is strip off about 6 inches of the braid to expose that inner braid and tie an overhand knot in the top. And the first thing to do whenever you tie a rig like this is put your hook bait on first. No point in guessing, get it right first time and you don't have to do it again. 7 turns along the shank of the hook and it goes back down through. Now, to make it even more effective, the original no-knot setup was good. I have the liner-liner adapter, which just ensures that that hook turns even more rapidly inside the carp's mouth. At the other end, there's a little loop tied, and I've got a tungsten anti-tangle sleeve on there, just to nail everything down on the bottom. Again, I don't change the length of it either, no matter where I'm fishing and what I'm fishing on. It's always somewhere between 6 and 7 inches, and again, has never let me down. One of the biggest things with using a flexible hair rig is tangles. I am the master. I can tangle anything. So in an effort to avoid all of that and make sure that my presentation is absolutely perfect, I use various PVA products. Out here, as I'm fishing over boilies, I'm using what I call the piles rig, which is 3 boilies tied up together like so. And all you do is push it through the center of them, pull the hook up and push it into one of the exposed areas of PVA. I can absolutely guarantee that that is never ever gonna tangle. And the other thing you've done, of course, is increase the attraction around your hook bait. An absolutely perfect setup. And again, one that I use on any bottom in any situation. My time in Romania is rapidly running out, and I'm just about to settle down for my last night. We're away very early in the morning to get the flight back to London. It looks very much as if nighttime is the right time for a bite. Out of the 6 bites I've had, 5 of them have come in the hours of darkness. So hopefully there's 1, maybe 2, you never know, more surprises that Romania has for me. It's a huge country, very flat, and the sky is absolutely massive. And the cloud behind me is starting to go a very red color, and it's quite spectacular. I love the place, as I said before. I would just like to catch a couple more carp before I go. Again, the conditions have dictated how I can do that. But as we settle down for the night, the confidence levels will go up. So hopefully in the early hours, I'll have something good to report. But if I don't, it's been a wonderful trip and I've enjoyed the experience massively, the country, the people. And although I haven't caught a great deal of them, the carp themselves. Romanian adventure is over. It's time to head for home. The rods are still out, or two of them are. I've even taken the hangers off of them and packed those away. Like any carp angler, I've left a couple of the rods out just until the very last second. It's been an amazing trip on a whole host of levels, and I have absolutely thoroughly enjoyed myself. We never thought I'd catch anything over 40 pounds, and we did just that. I'm gonna pack it all away now, and it's time to head for home. That really was the most rewarding of trips, which, if I'm being completely honest, looked at one point like turning into an utter disaster. Following on from that, we're going on a very tricky end of year session with a few members of the team who travelled over to Ribiere in France. The lake itself over the previous weeks was proving a real tough nut to crack, and it looked like the guys really had their work cut out to achieve any kind of result.
Certainly coming to places like Ribiere, it's allowed me to fish for fish that I would never ever dream of being able to fish for in England. And yeah, you know, just coming away and having a good time, a good social with friends, you know, everyone that's out is a good bunch of lads, and knowing that every time that that rod goes off, it could just be, and on this occasion, you know, it has been, so yeah, unbelievable. This is lovely, isn't it? So, after a bit of a drive through France, we've arrived at the fantastic Ribiere. As you can see behind me, the lake is absolutely amazing. We met David, the owner, on arrival. He's taken us for a little tour of the lake, fishing from one bank, nine pegs. Me, Bart, my old man, Scott, and Lee will be fishing the night. So we've had a little pick of swims, and after a little bit of delegation, we've all managed to sort ourselves out. I'll be going in pegs one, my dad in two, and we've not fished together for a little while now, so it'd be nice to have a bit of a social. Scott's coming up into peg four, Bart's in seven, and Lee's gonna go in peg nine. So we're quite spread across the lake. It's sort of 3 o'clock now, so we've only got a couple of hours of daylight left. That's what we're gonna do. We're gonna go up, bring the vans down, unload the kit, get set up, and get the rods in the water.
Fashion. I lost one earlier. Well, I say I lost one, I had a funny occurrence. Nothing come of it. Yeah, and then this one's just gone. This is the rod that I re-chucked actually. Chucked it back out, wasn't quite happy with it, so recast it again. And it's gone again. I think I passed out last night after that long drive. Nice to get a bite considering last week it done two fish between a few guys, and I've not really, you know, I've seen a fish short down to my right, but I've not seen any fish like where I started fishing. So yeah, it's nice to get a bite, especially, well, you know, to break the old duck's back as well, get a bite on the first night. sort of settles the nerves a little bit. Yeah, if it's 60 or 70 pound, I won't complain. When we were chatting with David, the owner, yesterday, he was telling us that this is, you know, this is a heavily, because of the distance to the far bank, there's no fishing on the far bank, and it's 140 yards plus. He was saying that it's a bait boat dominated water, which, you know, to be fair, a lot of French venues are. And that he can actually count on one hand how many people spod on here. And especially to the likes of me and Tom, that's like red rag to a bull. And I'm sure Harry as well, he'd love to be on here spotting the death out of it. But basically we just fished the old default setting in a nice little baited area. Got a couple of rods on it. You know, I don't know how many 60 pounders are in here and how many 50 pounders, but there's a lot of them. And eat 50 or 60 pound for eating 10 grains of corn out of a bait boat. No chance.
Oh, hello, Zipline, yeah? Let's have a look at you.
How about that?
What an absolute banger. Look at that.
Pure Zipline. Yeah, that's absolutely insane. Made up already.
You can help me, Lee, if you wish.
Yeah, he's zeroing it up. Turn these bad boys on.
What's it weigh?
£3.2, mate. Let's press zero.
There's not a scale out of place up there, is there?
55.5.
35 pound of absolute belting Zipline, yeah. First night, you know, get a fish like this under your belt on the first night of your session. It's absolute quality. I know Lee's, he's a bit jealous, but you don't need to say anything, do you, when you do it like this. It's absolutely lovely.
Bart was on fire. He had one first night. I think he lost another one, maybe lost another one. So three bites in the first night. It's also exciting on the first night. You don't know what to expect, really. You know what's in front of you. But it all sort of settled down from the second day onwards. You sort of get into a routine, putting your bait out, you know, knowing what's what, where's where, and you find your spots, and that's when you really start to angle for them.
We've had one fish on the bank, so basing on what's happened at the minute, spotting clearly works. Tight lines clearly they don't care about. And I think it's just the case that the fish are everywhere, and if a fish comes over you and wants to feed, you're gonna probably have a bite.
Well, it's the first proper day today. The other lads are getting their gear sorted, getting their rods back out to make sure they're 100%. I kind of feel like I'm fishing at 100% at the moment. Yesterday I found a spot. The far bank, although it is a distance across, it's quite featureless. And the peg that I'm in, there's a couple of trees that are in the water, and they are the two biggest trees in the lake. I've had a proper walk round today, but I've stayed well clear of them. The reason for that is because I think as the week goes on, if there's any pressure, I feel like the fish might move into that area, and I don't want to go right across to the far bank
and to the best feature right at the start of the week. I want to see if I can catch some fish elsewhere first and then go across there if it gets a bit harder and I can see them there. I'm not happy using a bait boat. I've never really used them. I've used rowing boats, that's not a problem. But I just don't feel like I can feel like I'm fishing 110% by using a bait boat.
Right, forwards, Mark. Well, Mark, this is Mark's attempt at driving a bait boat.
So I'm gonna, you know, it's fishing hard, so I'm gonna do what I'm confident in. I'm gonna use what bait I'm confident in, what, you know, the rigs and the tactics that I use to catch me a fish the best way I can, and to me that's gonna be casting from the bank, and I'm gonna be fishing a little area that I can sit there, I can sit on my hands, and I know that if it is fishing hard, I feel like I'm gonna be maximising my chances. The way I started my session was, I've gone across with a plumbing rod and dragged it across from the hard ground into just where the softer sort of silty clay starts, and it's about 8.5 foot there, but the rest of my pegs only goes down to 9 foot, but that's a lot closer. So I've started there, and I put some bait on a spot. I put a couple of rods in it, and I started off with some sweet corn, a few handfuls of maggots, and some crushed switch boilies. As for the rig, it's super simple, like normal. It couldn't be any simpler. There's no braided main lines, no braided leaders on this lake, so I'm just using a tapered mono leader, and that's down to just a simple leg clip setup. That's a naked tail rubber, a slit leg clip, so the lead can come off really easily, 4 ounce lead to get the distance, and there's a bit of a side wind as well, so when I'm hitting the clip, it's gonna stay nice and straight and not kite to the left with the wind when it does hit the clip. And then just an anti-tangle sleeve, 15 pound matte Cortex, that's the gravelly brown, just to match the color of the bottom and the color of the lake. A little kicker on the hook there, a size 4 wide gate beak point, and a 10 mil pineapple and banana pop-up. There's no imitation baits on this lake, so you can only use real pop-ups, and this is absolutely perfect. That just slowly sinks down with the weight of the hook, and that also almost matches the free offerings when the fish are feeding on the small items. And that's it, really. That is the rig. That's what caught us the fish. But yeah, what a great start.
At the minute, around the pan is a lot more productive than in front of me. You know, handling a nice sausage at 9 o'clock in the morning, you work out 200 nights a year. 3 sausages a morning.
Only 200 nights?
600 sausages per year I handle.
One could say you're an expert sausage handler.
I am.
Quite nice, to be fair. So I thought I'd come down into the old social area. Got me slaves cooking me breakfast. Lee had every fish in the lake in front of him. Caught absolutely naff. So far, Lee's only supposed to be fishing the
fish in
the nights, and he's had his rods out longer than everybody else.
Should have had one. But I think Bart's cutting them off coming into my bay, personally. Mark's bow shot. It's my turn now, Mark. Keep it down. I should have had one last night. I had 4 fish. Well, 4 big ones jumping all over me last night, and didn't happen.
Between me and you, I've had 8.
Don't laugh. Not telling these lot.
They think it's rock hard, it's frying their brain. Just keep catching them, putting them back. Let it mess with their minds, screwing them up. Tom's relentless. Thinks he's at B1.
The weather is good.
That's 14 degrees, November, southwesterly wind with a 998 low pressure.
Rubbish.
We're sat out here trying to catch a carp and we can't catch anything.
After Bart had caught on the first night, and it was definitely the approach that sort of me and him had, you know, both said that we would use when we come over here. We just thought, you know, three rods on an area, here we go. This is going to be a fantastic week's angling. But, you know, it didn't happen on the second day. And I think, if I'm honest, got a little bit panicked by it. Sort of, we fish like that, for, you know, a lot of our fishing back home. And because it didn't happen on the second day, like I say, we panicked and started doing some rash things.
Okay, so we're two nights into our trip at Ribiere. The fishing is proving to be a little bit difficult. Bart managed one on the first morning, 35 pound, absolutely stunning linear. Nothing for anyone else. So we're down in my peg now, I'm in peg two. My dad's just behind me in peg one, and these are deemed to be quite prolific areas of the lake. Seen a couple of fish, started with just my normal approach of finding a nice area, spotting it up, two rods on the spot, and then just fishing one off of the side. And as I said, nothing so far. A sponsored lad called Julian, a French lad, he's come down today, given us a bit of advice. He's a local lad, fished here for years, knows the lake like the back of his hand. And the first thing that he said is fish across to the far margin. There's fishing from one bank only, so therefore the fish are not pressured on the far bank. So what I'm gonna do, have a slight change of plan and slight change of approach, and I'm gonna go across to the far side. Where the water's a little bit shallower. Where I'm fishing is 12 foot, and across to the far side it sort of goes up to about 3 foot before eventually it's too shallow to present a bait. So what I'm going to do is, you can walk all the way around the lake. I'm going to take this little bad boy, which is a wireless fish finder. Most people have these attached to their bait boat. I haven't brought a boat with me, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to go around there with this. Some people would see it as cheating, but me, I think it's a massive edge. We're only here for a week, I've never fished the place before, and I want to be going home having caught a fish, not driving home regretting that if I'd have chucked this out, I may well have caught a fish. So I'm gonna get my little fish finder, my little screen, go around the other side. Hopefully I can find a few fish and an area to chuck a rod across to it. So let's have a little trek on around there. Right, I've been round to the other side, chucked my fish finder out, found roughly where I wanna be, which is between sort of 8 and 9 feet of water, popped the float up, obviously from the other bank, so I can see the float now, quite visible from here. Got my rig on my rod. What I'm gonna do now is I'm just gonna welly it out there. Bart's on the far side. He's down there on the phone on loudspeaker, so he's gonna tell me exactly how far, or indeed far away I am from the float. So I'm gonna do a few chucks. He's gonna tell me where I need to go. I'm gonna put it in a line clip, blast it out there, and then go around, throw some bait over it, and that'll be me for the night. And that's me change of plan and change of tactic, and hopefully it brings a bite or two. So yeah, here we go. Fish cracks off. I could take a 6 foot orangutan straight out of a tree. It's looking good, it's got the legs.
A bit short.
How much short?
You want about another rod length and a half.
Right, okay. That weren't a bad first guess at 150 odd yards anyway, so. All right, getting me drop right. I'm having it. I'm having it. I'm gonna go at this rod like I go at me chips, hard and fast. Are we ready?
That rod you just chucked there is bang level with it, the rod length off to the left as you look at it.
Right, okay. So they're out there. Rig-wise, I'm going for the good old faithful 360 rig. Speaking to David, the owner in here, the fish are extremely pressured and they're quite riggy fish. And I know
And after watching what happened at Wraysbury with the 360 rig, that if I use that same rig here, I feel it's giving me the best chance of hooking a fish should it come onto my baited area. So I'm fishing naked. I've got 20 pound Exocet mainline straight through to a naked tower rubber, leg clip just so the lead can eject, quick change swivel. Rig wise, 360 rig, size 7 medium curve shank hook, size 11 ring swivel, 35 pound matte Cortex. This is extremely stiff, so when I'm chucking it at the distances, which I am, I know I'm not going to get a tangle and my bait's going to be presented. Hook bait wise, yellow pop up, putting quite a bit of sweet corn in the mix. I know David again has said that's what the fish like out here, so going on the owner's advice, that's what we're using. Yellow pop up, whittled down, just so it sinks down nice and slowly and it's neutrally buoyant. So hopefully when a fish comes over it, sucks it up, the wig's going to fire back in its mouth, spin round, hook's going to set home, and we're going to land ourselves a French unit. On the second day, I did start to question myself and think, Bart's had a fish out of shallower water, should I chop and change? And certainly, yeah, I did. At that point, I panicked and I changed and I went right across to the far side where it's shallower. And then, yeah, I just sort of sat there and had a little chat with Dad, and then all of a sudden his rod's gone in 14 feet of water. Just makes you think, just not to move your rods, doesn't it? Like yesterday, we wound in and the fish were fizzing on our area, and then this morning decided not to change them, not to move them, and this is gone. So I was just in the process of tying up a rig to chuck to a fizzer, but I honestly believe the fish are out there and it just takes maybe two or three to get on you and have a feed up for a bit of competition for one to actually pick your bait up. It's like anything, if a fat kid went past McDonald's enough, eventually he would go in there. That is a big fish. I'm not an expert on 50s. That's big fish, that. That's a 50 plus. Might even be a 60. I don't really know what it looked like. Flipping hell, that is massive. That is big fish. Right.
Speechless. Probably good for your editing, actually, Harry, that I am speechless.
That's big fish. It's massive fish. Yeah, it is a massive fish. Right.
First bite of the trip.
We're at 24 pound, hanging off the floor. 50, 52, 15. Nice. Well done.
Now look at that, first bite of the trip, and it's a 52 pounder. What can only be described as three very, very frustrating days. Last night it must have been well in excess of 200 shows up this end of the lake. Not a bite, but rather than wind the rods in, decided to leave them out over the bait, and sure enough, just before lunchtime, it's rattled off absolutely over the moon.
I think the reason we struggled to start with may not have been down to the way we fished or our ability. I had a theory. There was two guys that were in these two pegs last week. Both bait boat users, I'm not going to knock bait boaters or have a debate about it, but if you're not catching anything, sometimes the biggest mistake people make in France is by keep changing baited areas. If something doesn't happen after 24, move it. And I think the area out in front of us was littered with bait, little pods of bait where they dropped it with a bait boat. Each night we have seen more fish than you could throw a stick at. It has been carnage out there. Massive, massive fish jumping all over the place. And I do wonder that if by the time we got to sort of late Tuesday, early Wednesday, certainly by late Wednesday, the fish had cleared up a lot of the bait. So then it was down to our baited area and the way we baited it. The destiny of them spots was down to us.
And from that point, I sort of thought, you know what, just go back to what you know, put your rods on your baited area. And as Dad just said, you know, all of the little patches of bait that were in a peg from the previous week had been mopped up. So then basically the fish only had one area to feed, and that area was the one with the hook bait.
After the events of this morning, we'll just have a little look into the rig that I used to catch that fish. First 24 hours I spent with small brown pop-ups. There was no pickups, no liners, no nothing. So this morning we had a little change of plan and went with the corn rig. Basically what I've done, put a small piece of yellow foam as a stopper, that's on a rig swivel, three pieces of real corn, and then because of the fishery rules and artificial bait, I put a mainline topper on just for some buoyancy. That's attached multi-rig style to a one of the new size 5 beak point stiff riggers. That's tied to a length of Camatex semi-stiff. I put a blob of putty around the knot. Basically that's just to add a little piece of weight. When the fish takes the bait in its mouth, it just drops, adds to the weight, drops the point. The coated material is actually broken there, so it gives, if you can see that, it sort of gives a 90 degree bend. Again, just so you've got that movement inside the fish's mouth. A little bit further along, there's a little blob of putty. That's just purely to help pin it down. At the end, got a tungsten anti-tangle sleeve. Again, every little bit helps, pinning the rig down. And when you get to the other far end, you've got a loop just purely for ease of change onto a quick link. And all that is attached to a just a simple lead clip system. There's a no lead core rule on the fishery, so I've opted for a lead clip system, naked tail rubber, and I've got a tapered main line, which is very heavy at that end. And it sinks, so I've not bothered using tubing, just gone naked all the way through. So, yep, that's it. Fourth morning now, I've had a rod. There's a bridge about 120 yards out there. Constantly baited it for 3 days. Nothing. And, last night I just moved the rod. It's been fishing in 10 foot of water. I just moved it closer to the bank, moved it into 7 foot of water. And yeah, I've had a bite. Days. There's so many big fish in here, it could be, there's only a handful of fish under 30 pounds. So.
Oh. Avalinia.
Love them. Look at that. That is absolutely
stunning.
One stunning creature. Yeah, definitely an upper 30s. Stunning, stunning fish. Look at the scales on that.
Nice. 39.7.
Lovely. £39.7. Happy days. Right. Gonna stick him back in the water in the sling, get the camera gear ready, and then we'll do some shots in a while. Right, just put the fish in the retainer. Let's hope they're still on the feed. We're gonna get this rod straight back out. What we're doing is, Tom's over to my right. He casts the lead onto the far bank, just in front of me, hopefully. Here it comes. There it goes. Right, there's the rig. Got a bag of corn, new hook link, boilies in my pocket, and we're gonna go and drop it off the bridge. Right, this isn't gated off because we're breaking the rules. It's because David's got two young children. He doesn't want them coming on here. Get the rig on. Without my glasses. Check there's a bit more. Just want slightly more of a loop down the shank. The idea being that the bait sits like that. And you can allow the bait to travel up the loop, up the shank of the hook. Just going to lower this down. We was further that way. We was here when we had the bite. Between the fourth and the fifth one. Just move the lead. It is silty on the bottom, but there's no leaf debris, so I'm just going to bounce the lead forward just to separate it from the rig. There you go. Right, a few boilies, new prototype one from Mainline, seems to be doing the business. A few crushed. Half a bag of corn. Let's get back to the rod quickly. Set it up, nice tight clutch, heavy bobbin. Don't give them an inch, we don't want them going under here. There we have it. £39.7 of stunning Ribiere mirror carp. Had it on a bait that'd been out there, or an area that I've been baiting for 4 days now. I'm not sure the fish hadn't been visiting it, they probably had, but stuck with it. Didn't want to have another baited area, give them a chance to feed somewhere else, and this is the result. Absolutely chuffed to bits with this one. Right, just before we put it back, each of the swims is supplied with its own fish protection and care kit. Just going to clean the mark off with the antiseptic, just rub it in, and on the hook hold there, just in the corner, that's just purely an antiseptic, and then we're going to spray some propolis on it just to seal the wound. One in the corner of the mouth. Second for it to just solidifies, just covers it up. Lovely. Job done. That can go back.
Right, well, 4 nights in, and ever since I've been here, I've had a baited area. It's about 170 yards across here, so I just
picked a nice comfortable distance. I went for 120 yards, 30 rod lengths, bottom of the riverbed. David, the owner, said that the fish patrol up and down it. And to be honest with you, it's been a bit of a headbanger, to be honest. I've kept putting bait there and fishing it and nothing. Fish are showing all around it, they're fizzing near it, you know, doing me, no doubt. And this morning, about 10 o'clock, I had the bite, and unfortunately, come off not long into the fight. Put the rod back out in true linear fashion, if you like. Two rods back on the spot, five more spots over it. And we're a couple of hours after that now, and it's gone off again. So hopefully I can have a different result with this one and get myself my first Ribiere fish in the net. So I'm going to concentrate and play a fish like my life depends on it. Yes! Cheers. Yeah, well, I think it just shows, you know, when you come over to these venues, sitting on your hands definitely works. It's frustrating because, you know, we're probably fishing for 200 plus fish easily of over 40 pounds. And when they're bounding out over you all the time and it's just not happening, you start to question whether you can actually catch a carp anymore. And then, you know, going back to just stick to what you know, don't come over here and change anything. You fish all that time in England and you catch on rigs, and you know, you nail fish on rigs and you play them in, you know, give them the butt to get them in, and you know you land every fish. And lost one this morning and you sort of feel like, you know, am I doing something wrong? Is my rig wrong? Am I presenting it wrong? But it's no different. France, England, no different. So yeah, stick with what you know. And yeah, patience in this case has definitely paid off. So that to me looks like a big fish. There we go. 48 pound, 2 ounces of Ribiere Miracarp. It's Wednesday today, I've been here 4 days and stuck to the spot. And nothing, they've been showing all around me and it's been really, really doing my head in. Lost a fish earlier on and then a bit more bait on the spot and this absolute unit has made an appearance. Whoa, awesome. Okay, so the rods are back out in the water, back onto the spot where I caught that fish. And as you'd have seen a couple of days ago, I decided to go long. At the time, I thought it was a great idea. We'd known Bart had had a fish out of 7-8 feet of water, and I tried to do the same. Sort of panicked, really, I suppose. I put the rods over there thinking, oh, maybe they're feeding in 8 foot and that's where I've got to be fishing. The spot that I'd found previously was in 12 foot and it just wasn't any good. Panicked, and then, you know, sort of yesterday I thought, all I do really is fish 3 rods on a baited area and it always comes good in the end. So I brought the rods back over, clipped them back up, back out onto the spot. Not to say that they wouldn't have gone should I have left them over there, because they probably would have done, but we've come a long way and I don't want to be going home thinking, if I'd have had 3 rods on that spot, I would have probably caught, as opposed to having 1 there and 2 just blasted as far as I can. So
dropped back onto the spot and has produced me two bites this morning. When we arrived at the lake, there wasn't much wind on the water. We brought maggots with us, as well as boilies, sweet corn, and a few other particles as well. Put maggots in with the mix and sweet corn and a few bits of particle as well. Spotted that out, but over the course of the session, the wind's picked up, and with that, it's brought an undertow. So I've taken the maggots out of the spod mix and I've just gone back to good old faithful sweet corn. Spoken to David, the owner. A lot of the French guys that fish here use maize. I brought a lot of sweet corn with me and he said sweet corn is a fantastic bait. So what I've opted to do now is just to spod solely sweet corn and jazz it up with a bit of cloudy manila liquid. It's a real sort of nutty, caramelly liquid and I feel it complements sweet corn absolutely perfectly. So I'm putting, say, four or five spods out in the morning, a bit of manila liquid into that, and fishing my rods over the top. And then as and when I feel necessary, which normally I would top up quite a lot, you know, if I felt that I was getting done a lot, but out here I don't. And then just putting sort of four or five more out in the evening before I go to bed, and it has paid off. So we've got a couple of nights left. Hopefully, now the fish have settled in a little bit and they've cleared out any bait that was in the peg from the previous week, that I've got one area now for them to feed on. And hopefully, fingers crossed, that they decide to have a bit of a munch up and I can string a few more fish together. Just awoken after probably a 12-hour slumber in bed. Other than Bart's bit of activity on the first night, we haven't actually had anything through the hours of darkness. So you have been guaranteed a good night's sleep, really. And seen quite a lot of fish down this end again last night. It's so frustrating every night me and Dad have come back here after we've had some tea and sat here. And you know, at times it's been like listening to fish jumping in the stock pond. There's been that many of them out there. And Dad had a bite exactly this time yesterday morning. Harry come down with the camera, sort of, I should imagine, half hoping to get a bite, and literally just as he appeared, it ripped off. Said it's in a bit of fizzing. I couldn't really see from laying in my bed any fizzing, but they have been fizzing on me pretty much most mornings. And then, yeah, this one just, middle rod of three on bait, so you know, right in amongst the baited area, and it's gone. So I'm going to concentrate because it's Thursday today, and French law is a big fish Thursday, so we're fishing for a lot of them. So I'm going to focus on this. Dad's got his waders on ready, and hopefully we can see another Ribiere carp. Buy it. It's a texture. That ripped over as well, didn't it? I thought it was you, Dad, pratting around. Well, current situation is we've waited all this time, been told that two on one spot isn't no good, three on one spot isn't no good. And this is three on one spot. I've had this one on for probably 20 minutes. Now Dad is faced with the challenge of playing a fish with the other hand.
Mid-fight. Probably never seen this happen a lot before, but Scott is going to change the handle to the right side for me. Here he goes. If we drop one of these components...
Whoa, don't say that.
I don't know what's going to happen. Luckily, the fish is going that way. Here we go.
You achieved it.
It's like an F1 pit stop.
Yes!
I feel like a carp fluffer.
A carp fluffer?
Yeah. Sort his waders out, or sort Ann's reel out. You know those kind of people that they have at the beginning of those adult films that help out the dudes to be able to perform? Can't believe I've been that far up the inside of Maker's leg after we've not had a shower for 5 days. I feel like Zoe did on their first date.
They'll shake some, Dad, didn't you?
Always shake.
Especially out of here, I do, because you just don't know. But if you lost that shake, what's the point in going fishing? Well, you've been fishing for about 65 years now, Dad, and you still got it. Can you not go underneath that, Scott? Whoa! He's in there. Right, that's that one. Right. Got one in the net. No, we've got one in the net. My one's in the net while it went off. And I was playing my one. The other rod ripped off. Dad's picked that one up. Done a little bit of a pit stop halfway in. Changed the rear handle over. He's in the water. His one's just about to be netted now. So I'm going to go in and hopefully the old bean can land a unit as well. I'm coming in. Go on. Slowly. Slowly. Cool. Well done. Said about the second rod being the biggest fish, and to be honest, yeah, it's a double take, give one to the old boy. I'm well happy with that. Oh, I'm so happy. I'm so, honestly, that's just ridiculous. I'd have said that one felt, I know that one's a 40, good for mid 40, upper 40, like that's a 60 pounder, it has to be a 60 pounder, I would have said. That's probably the biggest carp I've ever seen in the landing net. Get it out, right, get the scales out. I want to weigh it first, see how big it is. It's flipping massive. Don't look, me and Bart will read her off. Go on, you go, that's...
Go on, Scott. Oh yeah, it's a 60.
He's in the 60 club.
62.
62.
7.
Well, hey! Well done, old man! 62.
Oh, 62 pounder, Tom.
Well done, Dad. Jesus Christ, the old boy's done it. Start with a well, because every bit of filming starts with well. No, just had a double take, as you probably see. We've not weighed the one I caught. I mean, I just quickly bundled it in the net and then let Scott deal with it, but looking at that closer inspection, that's probably a close 50 pounder. Other rod's gone off while we're playing that. Dad's had himself a 62.7, which is unbelievable. That's what we come here for. Got the two rods back out, the one rod that hadn't gone. Five more spots of bait over the top, and believe it or not, I've managed to squeeze into these waders, as you can probably see. And yeah, the other rod's gone off, so
I don't really know what to say. I'm just going to play this fish in and hope and pray that he comes in. You know, and at this stage of the fight, it's so far out, and you know, it's easy to say, oh, it feels massive, but realistically, if you're coming out to Ribiere, the chances of you hooking something that isn't massive is highly unlikely. So at the minute, this is still 120 yards out. Feels like a dead weight, but I'm gaining on him. This is the point where I should have a Morris moment and cry. But I don't really know what to say. We come out here, not really knowing. You know, we spoke to a few people on Facebook and got a bit of information about what's in here and, you know, what they catch. And before you set off, you always think, oh, you know, I'd love to be one of them ones that goes there and catches the big one. And, you know, four nights in, and Bart just had the 35 pounder, it was beginning to look a little bit like maybe we'd hit it at the wrong time of year. But it's mad what a bit of patience and a couple of days difference can make. Dad's got the ball rolling with a 52, and he had a 39, and I was still sat here in a peg next door, which, you know, making no bones about it, deemed to be probably the best peg on the lake. Sat there every night, fish were crashing over me, sort of getting frustrated. I was chopping and changing, I was rowing, well, towing rods to the far side as hard as I could hit them. But eventually stuck with the spot that I first started to bottom to when I got it, which is what I do everywhere. And it, you know, it just proves that coming to these places, just because you fish you fish a certain method in England, don't come all the way over to here and think that you've got to fish something completely different. Because I've come over here, I've used the same rigs, the same baiting approach, spotting little and often, and it's paid off. There we go. What an absolutely awesome trip. You know, my old man, he's taught me everything he knows, bless him. I've been moved away from home for 4 years. I'm not giving you a life story, and I haven't actually fished with him for probably 6 or 7. But to share moments like this with him, unbelievable. My one's 51. Dad's snuck in there with a 60. What an awesome way to finish what has been an absolutely fantastic trip. Look at that.
I ain't lifting this on. Yeah.
There he goes, 50 pound of Ribiere mirror carp.
Thank you very much.
He's there. Well done.
Cup of tea?
Yep. Bacon roll. Style. Jesus Christ.
If I was to advise a friend coming out here, stick to your guns. Definitely stick to your guns. Don't get into that trap where you haven't caught in the first 24, you haven't caught in the first 48. You know what's working, you're a carp angler, you've caught loads of carp before, just stick with it. A carp is a carp. The tweaks you need to make at these venues are small. You know, you're fishing for bigger fish, you're probably fishing further out or whatever, but don't think you've got to change your whole approach just to catch a carp in France.
Fishing venues like this, I haven't actually fished a lake in France solely with a big stock of fish, knowing that if I get a bite, it could be something absolutely enormous. So I, you know, enjoyed it. I know it's easy to say now that I've caught, but even listening to what's out in front of you is just enough to, you know, to keep you getting up in the morning and recasting and making sure everything's spot on. Because when that rod does go off, and believe me, after losing what felt like a good fish yesterday, when the fish is in the net, it's just, yeah, you can just put everything behind you and it, you know, absolutely phenomenal. And the place is phenomenal and you couldn't ask to wake up in a more ideal location.
How about that for an awesome end to what has been an absolutely fantastic week. £40.08, dad is £40.07. Although it started off as a bit of a struggle in the end, 11 fish banked, the smallest 35, the biggest 62, with a couple of 50s thrown in for good measure as well. What an absolutely fantastic place, top owner, and we hope you've enjoyed watching this section as much as we've enjoyed filming it.
An incredible end to a very, very difficult week's fishing. And that brings us to the end of this DVD. We can only hope that you've enjoyed the footage and can incorporate some of our edges into your own fishing. Until next time.